You're listening to Fade to Black with your host, Jimmy Church, on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Don't run and hide. Don't be afraid. Don't turn away any longer. The truth will set you free. And now, your host, the captain of conspiracy, the prince of paranormal. This ain't your daddy's radio network show. This is Jimmy Church, Fade to Black.
All right. Great Friday to everybody. This is Fade to Black. It is Friday, February 7th, 2014, 38 days into the new year. As always, we are live from the JP Motorsports Studios right here in Burbank, California. Freezing cold, rainy Burbank, California. For KJCR and the Dark Matter Radio Network, I am your host, Jimmy Church. Welcome to everybody listening around the world right now. We are live. And you know how I start off every show. Started off with a big salute to the proud men and women in uniform all around the world fighting the good fight for us. Without them, there is no me, there is no you, there is no us, and you can't hear me right now. Think about it. Let's get this show cracking, everybody. We got a great one tonight. Happy birthday to my man, James Spader, 54 years old. Love that new show, The Blacklist. I knew that was going to be a good one when it started. Happy birthday, James. Also, Eddie Izzard. That's right. Eddie Izzard, 52 years old. And our dead guy birthday today, Charles Dickens, who died in 1870 and would have been, check this out, 202 years old today. Charles Dickens. As always, follow us on Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. Everything is Fade to Black, Jimmy Church Radio, J Church Radio. You guys are on the internet right now listening to this show. You know what to do. Go and follow, go and like, go and subscribe. That's how you stay in touch with this show. The show is all about you. It's all about being interactive, participating, hanging out, posting, getting involved in the forums. That's what this show is. Tonight, we'll take some calls. We'll do some open lines in the third segment. We get around to that. 323-825-5045 is the call-in number. You can also Skype Fade to Black 14. Okay, you can also email throughout the show. You know how we do it here. Email me to Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. You can do it all over the website where we use non-NSA special encrypted computers. You feel shaky on the keyboard? Just go to the contact page. Email us direct. The bumper music tonight, Doug Aldrich from Whitesnake. Thank you, Doug. We have the new virtual viewer of the Mayan pyramids. Just go over to the contacts page. It's right there at the bottom. 3D. Go cruise around some Mayan temples. It's very cool. And it is the reason to possess the internet in your home is that 3D viewer. And I'm not kidding. Also, this show is another reason. The new forums page, I will go jump in after the show. Go hang out with everybody, chat, talk, post. You know what to do. I really dig interacting with everybody. And at the bottom of the page, and I'm going to talk about this later on in the show, is the UFO landing pad. There's a couple of things there of interest. Go look at those pics, especially the one from Spain and the one from Russia that were taken 22 years apart. Go and look at those over at JimmyChurchRadio.com. Stan's blog, we have the new article, which is The Lost Indus Civilization. Go and check that out again. Go learn something. And the Easter egg contest, everybody. Check this out. We got another winner last night. Amanda and Amanda Champ. She successfully navigated everything, and she's winner number two. Now, I've got one more DVD that we're going to be giving away on this contest. The contest is simple. Go to jimmychurchradio.com. We have Easter eggs posted all over the website. And if you don't know what an Easter egg is, go and figure it out. It's a contest. And each Easter egg has got something tied to it. Email it back. Give me the correct number. We've got one more winner that we're going to do tonight. Congratulations to Dave and Amanda. You've won the first two. And again, it's easy to do. Now, before we jump into the show, I do want to say that we've got a gallery posted on jimmychurchradio.com for tonight's guest. And if you go to the homepage for jimmychurchradio.com, just scroll down, you'll see a gallery right there. It says Bryce Zabel. And we'll talk about some of these picks, but also tonight during the interview, and you wonder, you know, what does this guy look like? What are they talking about? Well, that's what you do. Just go right there and figure it out, okay? And so throughout the show, I'm going to reference back to those picks, okay? Now, listen, I'm going to go ahead and take a quick break. When I come back, we will have live from Berlin, Bryce Zabel. You guys stay with us. This is Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. We are on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Get the emails going. We will take your calls later on. Third segment, 325-825-5045. Email is jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. Follow us on Twitter @JChurchRadio. Back right after this.
You're listening to Jimmy Church Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
What's up, revolutionaries? It's me, Jimmy Church. Do you have an IRS or state tax issue? Well, I did, and I called national tax experts. My problems were fixed, done, fini, and man, I gotta tell you, it was a relief. National Tax Experts are a recognized tax office that services clients in all 50 states. Doesn't matter where you live. Give them a call. I'm telling you, they take the time to understand each and every client's individual financial status as well as their financial goals. And that's exactly what you need, my brother, when you're taking on the evil three-letter. So, seriously, give them a call today at 1-877-909-5444. Again, 1-877-909-5444, or go check out their website, www.nattaxexperts.com. That's NATTAXEXPERTS.com. Tell them Jimmy sent you.
This is KJCR at JimmyChurchRadio.com
on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
All right, everybody, welcome back. KJCR, Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network. I am your host, Jimmy Church. Welcome, everybody. Welcome. We've got a great, great show tonight. To end a great week of radio, and I'm serious, it's going to be a good one. Shoot me an email to jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. Follow us on Twitter @JChurchRadio. And I don't want to delay anymore. I just want to get this going. So let's do it. CNN correspondent turned screenwriter Bryce Zabel has created five primetime network television series. A produced feature writer in both live action and animation, he has written and produced for nearly all major networks and studios and collaborated with talents like Steven Spielberg and Stan Lee. Most recently, Bryce has concentrated on material based on true stories. The Last Battle, about the final week of World War II in Europe. Majic Men, about the investigators who broke the Roswell story. And Betty and Barney, about the classic Betty and Barney Hill abduction case. He has received credit on produced films and miniseries that include Atlantis, The Lost Empire, Mortal Kombat, Annihilation, Blackbeard, and the Poseidon Adventure. He wrote sci-fi's first original film, Official Denial. He has worked for ABC, NBC, CBS, Fox, HBO, Showtime, Sony, Warner Brothers, 20th Century Fox, Universal, Sci-Fi, Hallmark, USA, and Animal Planet. In addition to the Emmy-winning Dark Skies, Bryce has created, developed Kay O'Brien, Mantis, The Crow, Stairway to Heaven, and ENG. His other series work includes working with Steven Spielberg's Taken, L.A. Law, Life Goes On, and Lois and Clark, The New Adventures of Superman. His current novel is Surrounded by Enemies, What If Kennedy Survived Dallas? And his previous nonfiction book, AD, After Disclosure, When the Government Finally Reveals the Truth About Alien Contact, received a fourth printing by New York's Career Press in 2013. I would like to welcome to the show, live from Berlin, Bryce Zabel. Bryce, how are you?
I'm great, although with all the jet lag of going to Berlin, I don't know whether to say Guten Tag or Guten Abend to you right now.
You said Guten Morgen earlier, so there you go.
I did, but so that shows I'm all over the map right now.
Oh, so how do you, we've got a lot to do, a lot to cover tonight, but I'm just going to get a couple of obvious things out of there. How do you deal with that kind of jet lag?
Well, it's interesting. Well, for me, you show up someplace and you go to bed and try not to get up until it's morning. But I don't know that's the right strategy. I do know now, and by the way, if you hear anything odd, I was sitting here, as you know, we talked before the show, and I was just sitting here in the hotel lobby, and now suddenly there is a guy vacuuming on one side of me and a guy cleaning carpets on the other. So if it sounds a little strange, you know why.
You could have come up with something more exotic than that.
I know.
And we would have believed
it. I'd like to say I was, you know, on board some mysterious craft over the skies of Germany right now.
Right. Or, you know, you've just been arrested and they're cleaning the walls of the Berlin jailhouse. You know, something cool.
I'll tell you something cool, though. I mean, the place where I'm here for the Berlin Film Festival and the European film market that goes along with it. And the place where the film market is headquartered is literally down, there's a giant piece of wall that is where it stood, and it's right in the whole Checkpoint Charlie area, very
right.
Historical,
right?
In a kind of a dark way. I mean, I find this is my first time to Berlin. I've been to Germany before. It's interesting to me because it's a city of great hope, obviously. I mean, here is a place that has reunited and has taken its place in the international community and is trying to get it right and doing a pretty good job of it. But it's also a place where a terrible darkness, you know, descended over the world. It's a place where, you know, literally about three blocks from my hotel is Hitler's bunker, where he died on April 30th, I believe, 1945.
Right.
So I'm surrounded by dark and light history at the same time. It's very unusual. I mean, all cities have that to a degree, but not to the extreme nature that Berlin does.
And considering it was bombed into the ground at one point, and it's, you know, it's like Phoenix rising from the ashes now.
Speaking of Phoenix, then it does feel like Phoenix in that most everything is at least new since 1945.
Right, right. Well, just let me say this really quick.
Sure.
For anybody that's new listening to this show, we're just going to have a conversation, everybody. And if Bryce and I find it interesting, you'll find it interesting too. There's no agenda. There's no questions, nothing like that. I don't have any notes. It's the way I do every show. Everybody's used to that. And so here we are. I've got lots of things I'd like to talk about, but right now let's just stay focused on what you just said, which is that wall was there on one side. That city was gray, depressed, you know,
yes.
Soviet influence. And then on the other side was commercialism and neon lights and fun and music and Van Halen, you know, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, absolutely.
Have the two kind of merged now?
They're merging more. I don't know if you're aware of it, but this is the 25th anniversary of the wall coming down.
Right.
So that's kind of interesting. And I think that there is a lot of what you were just talking about. The wall represents well, think about it. Most often people build walls to keep people out. The only time people tend to build a wall to keep somebody in is when they build a prison.
Right.
And so that was what was happening here in Germany from the fall of Berlin in 1945 through 62 when they built it. Many East Germanies, German citizens rather, were simply fleeing from East German Berlin to West German Berlin. And literally the East German government decided that's just not going to cut it, and they built this wall. And it truly did give a moral high ground to the West, because it allowed Kennedy to come and speak at the wall so famously, where he said, "Ich bin ein Berliner."
Right.
It involved Ronald Reagan getting the opportunity to come to the wall and say, "Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall."
Right.
And it's fascinating, and it is there. And it's interesting to me, though, that the pieces of the wall, in some places the wall has been left as a present. Certainly in this checkpoint Charlie area, it's left around. But the rest of it has been broken into pieces and dismantled. And literally in front of my hotel, there are a couple of pieces of the wall that are just standing there as art pieces. So the wall has become art. And most of the pieces you see around here were probably painted or whatever during the time that it was active. But then some of them have been simply used as canvases for the current art crowd. And it's very fascinating, and it's probably a good use of it.
Well, that's a really great point, though, that walls, you know, are built for one of two reasons, keeping somebody out or keeping somebody in. And in that case, nobody was jumping the wall from West Berlin, you know, going that direction.
No, nobody. It was, nobody
it was,
at all.
Yeah, it was to keep their own people hemmed in. I never really quite looked at it that way.
It's profound. But as you said, though, the biggest struggle for Germany after reunification was that you had literally two different countries. You had a very capitalistic and economically powerful half, and then you had a formerly communist and economically disastrous half.
Right.
And one brother had to reach out to the other brother and pull them up. And so for a number of years, there was this vast disparity, but from what I understand, and I'm not an expert on this part, but I do believe that the disparity has eased, and the full country is looking more and more like a single country, although not entirely.
Right. Now, you're there for the Berlin Film Festival, and we're going to talk about that in a second, but tell us a little bit, because your writing and your production work in film and television has had I don't want to say paranormal, but I kind of have to.
Yes,
you've got a strong influence there, but yet you come from a pretty educated background in broadcast. And so what I have to ask, and I'm going to probably go in about three or four different areas, and I don't know which one to go into first, but you went to school and you got into broadcast journalism. And so tell me about how did you start off at CNN, or did you start off like everybody else in Wichita?
No, it feels like it, though, now, because it was long enough ago. The memories have faded. But I actually started in local television news up in Eugene, Oregon. And I was a general assignment reporter and an anchorman and et cetera. And then I moved to Arizona, where I did the same thing. And I was lucky enough to move from Arizona to Los Angeles to work for the CNN Los Angeles Bureau, which was a fascinating and wonderful time and it's very funny, because when I watch Anchorman and Anchorman 2, those actually kind of parallel my early life. I literally had a Ron Burgundy haircut and mustache and sport coat back when I got started in Eugene. And by the time I got to CNN, I was sort of in Anchorman 2 stylings.
Right.
So I feel very, you know, that's the way it was. But honestly, coming to Los Angeles was just the greatest thing for me, because it opened up my eyes to a lot of things. And even though I came to cover the news in Los Angeles, being an industry town, is quite often the Hollywood aspect. So I got to cover things when I came working for CNN, I got to cover things like SAG strikes, and you know, I remember one of the first things that I covered was literally a picket line of famous Hollywood celebrities around the Warner Brothers lot.
And,
That's not how you think of picket lines, and yet in Hollywood, it makes sense. People are unionized. I'm personally a member of the Directors Guild, the Writers Guild, the Screen Actors Guild, and the TV Academy. So, you know, you do get organized, if you will, by your affiliations, and so it's not odd. But yeah, news for me led into the world that I'm in now, and was really one of the best things for it, because I always tell people what's great about covering news at the beginning of a career, particularly a writing career, is that two things. First, you get a wide exposure to the way things work on a just a massive, quick, sustained level. And that's fascinating. And you can draw on that for the rest of your life and your career. But the other thing is you tend in the news business, particularly the TV news business, to meet people in extremes. It's either the best day of their life or the worst day of their life. And
it's very rarely
a day in between. So it does give you a sense for drama.
When your did your journalism background, it appears to me, I just want to hear from you, did it affect your writing style and the way that you want, because you almost deal with your fiction is almost nonfiction, and vice versa, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, so, I try to do that. You're right. I guess it is. I guess that's the answer. Journalism does make you want to tell it in a way. I mean, for example, this current book I have out, Surrounded by Enemies, definitely reads, even though it's a fanciful book, it reads like a piece of journalism. And I do think journalism is a good place to draw from for inspiration, because it allows you to be direct, to get to the point, to not waste people's time.
And I think
readers, especially in a busy world, you don't want to short somebody, but I don't think you do anyone a favor by writing an 800-page book. I know, for example, Stephen King wrote a book on the same topic that's 900 and some pages. Mine is, I think, 300. But I'm very happy with mine. I think that, first of all, I wouldn't compare them. They're totally different. But I think that there's something I couldn't write a 900-page book, because it just goes against the grain for getting to the point. I mean, that gets beaten into you in journalism school and certainly, you know, on the job. And I will say one thing about journalism. It did give me my career, because I left CNN, and then I was on another job. I was an investigative news reporter for PBS, and that show got canceled. That's how a lot of things come to you from changes in your life. And my wife, Jackie, who I wasn't married at the time, but I was facing that situation where if I didn't if I didn't get out of the news business in some direct way, I would end up leaving Los Angeles to, say, be an anchorman in Green Bay or something like that. And so she said, well, maybe you should consider writing a screenplay. And back at the time, they weren't all online. So I said, I've never even seen a screenplay. So we got one, and I read it, and I thought, this actually is a style that I respond to. And the first thing I ever wrote, they always say, write what you know. So the first thing I wrote was something called ENG, which stands for Electronic News Gathering, sort of a Hill Street News, if you will.
Uh-huh.
And because it was so authentic, because it was drawn from my personal experience, people liked it. And I said, as long as they keep paying me to do this, I'll keep doing it. So knock on wood, I mean, I'm still doing it.
Where did you grow up?
Oregon. I was born on the Oregon coast in Newport, and then grew up near the Portland area. Seen vast changes in that state, of course. It's always been environmentally conscious. But I've seen it, you know, obviously when I went to the University of Oregon, the Duck football team could barely get arrested. They were so awful. We never went to the games. They were so bad. But now, contenders.
My, how times change.
Oh, my. Yes, indeed. But Oregon's a great place. I go back. I've gone back there and optioned, for example, one of the true life stories that I'm here talking to people about comes straight from Oregon. So there's a part of – I think that's true of everybody. Everybody carries with them all their life the place that they started in. For some people, it's very negative. For some people, it's very positive. For me, it's positive, but it never leaves you.
What happened in your life? There's something happened somewhere. I mean, I know when and where it happened with me, and something happened that took you into this ET extraterrestrial Roswell world that you're knee deep in now. What happened?
Well, in a way, it goes back to where we started. The skills that you bring from journalism, I think, took me there. I'll give you an example. I decided in, I guess it was the late 80s, I decided to write a film on the topic of UFOs, not only because I thought it was a good story. I honestly didn't know that much. I do remember as a kid my mother buying The Interrupted Journey or something from the book club, and I remember reading it and thinking, well, that's really strange. But I didn't really form too strong an opinion. But in order to write this movie, which actually became Official Denial, which you mentioned was the first original film the Sci-Fi Channel ever made. Mm-hmm. In order to write that movie, I started doing the research because I wanted the movie to be authentic. Because as you said, you know, everybody's got a brand. My brand is to tell dramatic stories as if they're real. So I just read everything I could get my hands on. I talked to people.
Oh, so you weren't abducted as a child?
No, I was not. And I'll tell you what happened is I literally, the more I read, the more I just came to the conclusion that I think the UFO situation is a signal to noise situation. There is a whole lot of noise. There are a lot of crazy things that aren't true that are discussed about it over and over and amplified on, particularly in the internet age. But that doesn't mean there isn't a signal of truth, that there is a basic truth. And the truth for me that I've come to realize is that some of these things that are flying around in our skies are from some place that isn't here.
Right.
And they're piloted by somebody that isn't us. So once you accept that reality, your worldview changes dramatically. So I guess that's what happened.
How did you – the amount of research that it takes to do AD, After Disclosure, by the way, you know, one of the best books on the subject, if not the best. And I'm not saying that because you're on the show. It's – everybody says it. So there you go.
Well, I wrote it with Richard Dolan. He's one of the best himself.
And we're going to have Richard on. I mentioned this to you the other day. Richard's flying out, and on the 18th, he's going to be on the show here. But – we are taking the show on the road. We're going live in Studio City, and we're going to set up, and we're going to do the show in front of a studio audience and for the release of his new book. And so let's talk.
I think I'll come and heckle you then.
Well, you know, and I was just going to say, if you're going to be in town, but it goes without saying, now we're doing this live in front of everybody. But if you're in town, I can get you on the list. Okay.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. I appreciate that. You know, by the way, it doesn't change. Everyone in Berlin is trying to get on the list to get into the right parties, too. Yeah. I mean, it's the same everywhere.
Yeah, and it's funny. Hollywood. But the amount of research that you have to do for something like Dark Skies or AD or Denial, any of those subjects, as you started to peel back, you know, the layers, and you're mm-hmm. you're finding out something, and then you're finding something as it moved, were you just shocked because you didn't come from you know, this background as a child? If
no. So I was shocked a little bit. I think if you're not shocked, you're not alive. You have to be a little shocked when the switch trips in your brain and you say, some of this is real. And again, I want to differentiate. I'm not a believer that it's all real. Mm-hmm. I've seen disinformation. I've been actually targeted for disinformation. So I know that disinformation plays a very profound part of it. But then I have to ask myself, why would you be creating disinformation? I mean, what's the whole point of disinformation?
Right.
It's to distract somebody from something else. It is interesting on all the UFO projects that I've done. Quite often I start from a position of looking for a good story and then stumble into a better story by the research. I'll give you a great example on Dark Skies, which just to bring your audience up to speed, it was a NBC series that shot 20 hours of it. And the premise of the series, it all takes place in the 1960s. The premise is that John Kennedy was assassinated because he was going to tell the truth about UFOs in his second term. Okay, and it comes from an interest of mine that obviously now I've really made clear. The two books you talk about, one's about UFOs, one's about Kennedy. So I guess it is a theme I've returned to. But for Dark Skies, my creative partner Brent Friedman and I ask ourselves, what are the two biggest conspiracies of modern time? And they are, of course, UFOs and the Kennedy assassination. So we thought, well, let's put them in an atom collider and create the uber conspiracy, the greatest conspiracy ever, by putting them both in the thing. And so we did that, and we were developing Dark Skies and literally developed it with no knowledge about anything. And in the years since Dark Skies has aired, more and more people have started talking about the very thing that the series is premised on, which is Kennedy might have known something.
Right.
Now, for me, that was intuitive because I believe Roswell, and we'll talk about this later because it affects the Majic Men project that I'm also here for.
Right.
But I believe that Roswell is a true and authentic event, that it happened, and I don't, again, buy every aspect of it, but it happened, and it probably represents an extraterrestrial situation. So you have to ask yourself this. If that's true in 1947, then virtually everything that's happened from a governmental point of view over the years since has had some impact by that. And particularly when you think about the 1960s, John Kennedy took office a mere 14 years
exactly
after Roswell. So the fact that they wouldn't have swept it all up under the rug perfectly is very likely. The fact that Kennedy would have heard rumors but might have been kept in the dark is not impossible. So a lot of the assumptions we made turned out to be, I think, true.
When and you bring that, that is an awesome point, and let me expand on that a little bit. Do you think? I'm going to back up. I'm going to save that question for a second. Do you think you caused that thought to go into people's heads, or do you think maybe because the rumors about that did surface? I'm referring to Kennedy, disclosing. So do you think you perpetuated it, or do you think there was an inkling of truth there that you might have found out later that you just got lucky with the storyline?
Well, there's the rub, isn't it? Let me lay out the timeline. When Brent and I created Dark Skies and got it on the air, we were working on it for the first time. I think that we first started discussing it in 95. And there was nothing – first of all, the internet wasn't as – vibrant and easy to access. So we didn't actually get anything off the internet about it. We just made it up. I never saw anything that seemed to imply Kennedy and UFOs were related in any way during the creation of the Dark Skies series. Now, that's not to say that I'm denying that anything might have existed. I'm just saying I never saw a bit of it. And then over the years, as Dark Skies had its run, and I would call it at the time charitably a cult hit for NBC, but not a big enough one on Saturday nights pre-DVR to stick around. But certainly people who cared about the topic talked about it, watched it, and thought about it. And it is true exactly what you say. Since then, I've started to see more and more stuff percolating out, and even those Majestic documents, which the validity of the – I'm talking not the original Majestic documents, but the ones that came out in the early 2000s that deal with Kennedy, they certainly seem – if they're not real, then they certainly could have been inspired by what Dark Skies said. And over the years I've certainly had a number of people come up to me and say that they wanted to know how I knew.
Well, that's exactly. And so when you have the freedom to, when you're writing something like this, you can rely back. You have the freedom of history, so you can tie in the historical timing of different events. But then you have the freedom of going hardcore fiction and tying everything together, but then lo and behold that you stumbled upon something that actually might have happened when that wasn't your intention. You know,
it was crazy.
Yeah, I just can't imagine. I remember.
By the way, I just want to let me just throw this out there for people.
Sure.
People that are interested to that may have heard of Dark Skies, it is available now on DVD. But on YouTube, I have a collection of about 10 or 12 clips from the series that deal with the Kennedys and Dark Skies and Majestic 12 and the Warren Commission and all of that. They're all laid out on the internet at my I think you're going to put the YouTube URL up on your site.
Sure.
So people can go and watch those for themselves and draw their own conclusions. And then I would just also say, because I just think it's interesting, if you watch Dark Skies, Art Bell is a member of Majestic 12 playing William S. Paley. So that's always fun for people to see as well.
And the success, this is the thing for Dark Skies. You know, you had at that time in the 90s X-Files. And, right. And this show start, and it should have, to me, well, I, you know, one is different from the other, but they were both great. And I just don't, I wanted Dark Skies to have that 8-year run.
I did too, man. Know,
and it was really good. It's
so
what,
sad.
What year did it come out?
Brent and I used to say we'd finish it on, by handing out Xerox copies on the corner if we had to, but over the years it's just been impractical. I've tried very hard to get it restarted. You know what was interesting about that period? I mean, who isn't an X-Files fan that cares about these things? But
right.
Fans tended to, at that moment in time, were very protective of the X-Files. And so rather than seeing Dark Skies as like a wonderful side piece of entertainment that was in the same genre, like a couple of cop shows. You can like one cop show and like another cop show.
Happens all the time.
Medical show,
right.
And another medical show.
Right.
But apparently at the time, people didn't feel like you could like a paranormal show and another paranormal show. It was like choosing sides. And that was unfortunate because as time has gone on, more and more people have been able to watch Dark Skies because the Sci-Fi Channel aired it numerous times. And then also now with the DVDs that are available. And it really, when it gets a kind of a fair viewing, people tend to see that they're really not the same at all. They're very radically different. One of the things that Dark Skies wanted to do from the beginning is we tried to be not the X-Files. The X-Files was all about the shadows and the darkness and the mystery. And what Dark Skies did, we decided not to do that. In the very first scene of the very first episode, you see a UFO up
right.
close and personal as a piece of structural craft. So we decided, you know, we're not going to go down that. Our show is about they're real, they're here, you know, and they're hostile.
Right.
And that's the problem.
I remember the first episode, and I went, holy crap, this is made for me. This is great. This is on TV? Really? You know,
well, I always say the network, I believe, gave me $48 million in production funds to make those 20 hours. Maybe it was more, maybe closer to 50. But what I always think about that $50 million and the 20 hours that it created was that never has a network given more money to somebody to do something as subversive as Dark Skies. I mean, it is right. completely subversive of the order of things to say that that UFOs are real and that John Kennedy got assassinated over them, and everything else that you think you know about how the world is arranged is probably twisted and turned and pretzeled by that very piece of reality.
Did you ever think that maybe I'm sure this crossed your mind that, you know, somebody out there would be watching it and have their mind changed? Oh, I bet!
Yes.
I bet this is telling the truth. Oh,
it's interesting that you say that. I would say it's probably 50-50. I have, you know, obviously a lot of people who have not bothered to do any reading on the topic or whatever. They see it and go, "Well, that's a bridge too far. That's just crazy." But then people that have actually done a lot of reading, who, as I did, you know, formed the opinion that Roswell was a real event. It's not as crazy as it sounds. And it does make you think. And I'll tell you, one of the great things that Dark Skies did for me as a writer, as a researcher, whatever, is that when people knew that that I had worked on it, they knew I was not going to judge them. And so for years now, ever since, I guess, since 96 when the show premiered. I've had people, it could be a plumber working in my house, and he'll say, so you did that TV series, huh? And I'll go, yeah. The one about the UFOs, the dark skies thing, yeah. And they'll go, you know, I haven't talked about this since I was 12 years old, but, right. And then they'll lay a story on me. And I've had this happen probably 24 times over the years where people start by saying, I haven't talked to anybody about this for decades, but when I was, and then the story goes on, and these are people who are decent, hardworking, no bullshit people who
right.
are not making this stuff up, something that they're telling me actually happened. And it's been shocking, and it's informed, you know, my beliefs even stronger because I these are not crazy people.
Well, I say this a lot, but it's true. If anything happens, because I've had things happen in my life, and if anything crazy happens, you don't want to come off crazy. So right. you don't say anything ever. And right. you don't talk to your wife. You don't tell your friends. You don't tell, you certainly don't tell your boss. You know, you don't tell anybody. You keep it bottled up. But when you got an opportunity to speak to somebody that might understand, it's going to come pouring out. And you just
well, they're
happen
looking
to,
for answers. They want answers.
Right.
One guy told me this story. I'll give you the 30-second version of the story. But he was like 16 or 17 with a friend sitting out on the back porch in Texas, and they had a beer. They weren't drunk. They were having a beer after working in the afternoon. And a small object, maybe only a foot across, and this is like 1967, starts hovering around them and inspecting them and flying around them. And it was structural, it was metallic, and it floated and it hovered, and it was a UFO, but only a foot long, like a drone, maybe, I don't know.
Right.
But it lasted long enough that they went in the garage and tried to get a fishing net to catch it. That's how real it was, okay?
Oh,
and,
man.
And this guy told me, that over and that's what I like about that story is it's a high level of strangeness.
Right.
Okay? It's not your classic story that he read someplace else. It's just odd. And so he said that over the years he and his friend would call each other maybe every 2 or 3 years, and the conversation would go like this. The guy would say, "Hey, how you doing?" "Oh, good."
Okay, we're back. Little technical glitch, and that's what happens when you're talking about the NSA, the CIA, and you've got a guy like Bryce Zabel talking about conspiracies, JFK, what if he would have lived? He knew something. They just want to cut us off, Bryce. Are you still there?
You know, I'm here. Did we get cut off, or were we still on, but your system went down? What actually transpired?
You and I kept driving the car.
Okay, but was anyone able to hear us?
No, all the top secret stuff? No, nobody heard any of that stuff.
Oh, all right. Well, I'm not going to hear it now. I was going to say that I thought it was funny. As you're saying, you're going to blue screen, it's like somebody was sent to go polish the floor right next to me. And all I can say is that I heard someone in German saying the words General Frank Grass. That's all I know.
Well,
I think he was on the line to Berlin saying, you shut this down now.
You know, and the thing is with General Grass, and I don't know if he's listening right now, and for everybody out there, we were talking during the break. One of the Joint Chiefs, and I've never said his name over the air, by the way, Bryce, but he is a member of the Joint Chiefs, and he has been calling the show, and I won't pick up. And I look at his, you know, I mistakenly shared Skype information with the general, not knowing. I thought he was just a caller calling into the show. And he had called in right after the show had ended. It was a month and a half ago. And so I thought, General Frank. So I Wikipedia him, and I see that he's, you know, he's Homeland Security, Joint Chiefs, appointed by Obama, real dude, head of the National Guard, the guy. And And I'm like, what is he doing calling my show? And he called two nights ago. He called three times during the broadcast. And I'm scared. I don't want to pick up.
No, you got to talk to him. And the other thing, though, is my experience on that, too, is General Grass may very well have, you know, it's not always about manipulation. It may very well be that whatever you were talking about, he actually feels you're on the wrong track, you know, yeah, in all sincerity. Yeah. And yep. He might have been calling just to say, you know, listen, young man, let me tell you a thing or two about the way the world really works. So who knows, but love to hear from the guy.
Well, you know, I'm intimidated, except this is the thing. I was talking to Keith, you know, who's head of the network here, about this. And he said, pick up. The next time he calls, pick up. Maybe, you know, you never know.
You're in no danger by talking to somebody. But, you know, listen, I take most of this stuff with a grain of salt. However, when Brent and I were doing Dark Skies, we were targeted by somebody. Without getting into, I've told the details before, and I'm not going to take your show up doing it. But it was clear that somebody was trying to either spin us or give us inside information, one or the other, that they were trying to manipulate how we would tell our story in the show. And so we kind of cut that short, but it made me wonder again, as we said earlier, if someone's trying to spin you, what are they trying to spin you to, and what are they trying to spin you from, and why?
Yeah, it's not necessarily giving you the wrong information. It's taking you away from the right information.
Possibly. Well, you know, but then again, when you're doing a television show, you're making stuff up anyway.
Exactly.
So, you know, from a disinformation point of view, while I'm very proud of Dark Skies, I'm not here to claim that Dark Skies was, you can take it to the bank as the God's truth. We were telling a very dramatic television story where we took as much real things out of history and as much real things out of UFO events and wove them together. But, you know, we were doing it as dramatists, not as historians. So we were all, if there was any disinformation being filed, we were doing our job, I guess. You know, some of it's true and some of it's not true.
Do you think, and I hope you can answer this in a direct way, do you think that, you know, maybe the CIA or the government has influenced Hollywood and how they present, you know, ETs and UFOs to the public? Do you think there's any influence coming out of Washington, D.C. and telling a production?
That's a really huge question. I would say that if historically there definitely has been some indication of that, specifically back with those early Earth versus the Flying Saucers kind of movies,
right.
There was some connection. I think less so now. It's interesting you bring it up, though, because a good friend of mine, Robbie Graham, who many people know, is an expert on this and has written a book that will be out next year called Silver Screen Saucers. And in fact, Ben Hansen, who people know from the Sci-Fi Channel series that he did, and I are talking about making Silver Screen Saucers as a regular series because we think it's worth exploring. But I'll tell you my own opinion about that, though. I mean, even though we were approached by somebody, my tendency is to say that the idea that somehow Hollywood's been targeted and people have been given inside information and things like that doesn't strike me as being real and authentic. I'll give you the best example. I've met Spielberg several times. I worked on Taken, which was his UFO abduction series on the Sci-Fi Channel with him. And so we had conversations about UFOs, not him and me sitting down smoking a cigar or anything, but me and a couple of the other producers talking to him about some of the storylines. And while he seems informed about UFOs, he certainly didn't seem to have to be an insider pushing an agenda. And in fact, if you look at the work that Steven Spielberg has done over the years, he has done almost every side of it. He's done the benevolent space aliens of Close Encounters. He's done the cuddly scientist of E.T. He's done the badass aliens of Falling Skies. He's done War of the Worlds. I mean, if Steven Spielberg had been given an agenda of what he was supposed to help get out in terms of the story, then I'd question what it was, because he's either that or there's 150 different kinds of aliens out there, and he's given us a little bit of each one. I think the better answer for Steven Spielberg is he's attracted to the topic like I am, like you are, like many of your listeners are, and probably doesn't know that much more than anybody else does.
And I'm on the opposite side of the fence from you there, Bryce.
Okay.
I think I just feel it. I've met him too a few times, and in a weird way kind of worked for him installing, you know, I'm not going to get into that. But anyway, I feel like he knows something, because he certainly doesn't have any issues with putting it on the screen, getting budgets together, and devoting his life to it.
I don't get. I think this is a point of contention, because why shouldn't he do that? He's a capitalist filmmaker.
Right. No doubt.
And alien films work. I mean, look at how many alien films are made every single year. I'm walking through the film market. There's dozens of low budget alien films that they're trying to sell around here that most people will never see. Then there's all the big budget ones that come out every year.
Right.
You don't have to be motivated by any agenda to want to put this stuff out, because other than you want a successful film. So he's drawn to the topic. Well, thank God that he is. He's done a nice job with it.
But that's a great point too, as well. And I kind of drive this home once a week on one of the shows once a week, is this. And listen to this. Okay, I'm just going to rattle this off the top of my head. 2001: A Space Odyssey. Prometheus, yep. Close Encounters, E.T., Pacific Rim, Ender's Game, Battleship, Battle Los Angeles, all of the Transformer movies, I Am Number 4, Avatar, all of the Alien movies, Super 8, District 9, Starship Troopers, Men in Black, all of those movies, Independence Day, you just mentioned War of the Worlds, or Chronicle, or all the Predator movies, or Signs. How about Mars Attacks? You know what I mean? Or Cloverfield.
But I mean, what does that prove, though? All it proves is that more and more of us in today's world are interested in the topic, because we believe that there's a certain amount of truth to it.
Right.
But it doesn't mean that those filmmakers have been given any information over and above any other filmmakers. And it doesn't mean that that they have inside knowledge, or that the CIA or someone else has come to them and told them what's going on.
Well, but when you're right, yes, I agree and disagree at the same time, because what you're saying is absolutely true, except the public, and when you write a book like AD, okay, and Disclosure, then movies like this, it's the public that is paying for these movies. There's obviously a market there, and now it's not so much open-minded, it's about acceptance too. The idea now has been drilled home for so many years that if they did show up like Independence Day over New York, nobody's going to be shocked, because we've seen 30 movies this year about the subject. And so Disclosure would be easier now for the government, not only...
Maybe, but then here's what I would say about that. If the government was trying, you know, if somebody was trying to condition us for disclosure, then they're doing a pretty shitty job of it. Because what they're doing is they're all over the map. You know, those movies you named, I mean, are just wildly different and divergent in what they think. And frankly, most of the filmmakers just made, you know, the part of the problem I have with most of those films is they're not based in anything that I know to be actually the way it really is.
Right.
The way it really is certainly a lot more mysterious and mind-boggling, I think, than many of those films, which are straightforward. I mean, and if anything, a lot of what gets into a UFO series or film is a factor of what the studios or the network say. So, for example, in Dark Skies, you know, the Hive was a hostile alien force. Why? partly because...
Oh, are you there, Bryce? Okay, let's take a quick break, and I've lost Bryce, and we will get him right back. Let's take a quick break. You got to love this. I'll be back right after this. This is Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network. We're going to take a break at the top of the hour anyway, and that's the timing of it. Shoot us an email to jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. We'll grab Bryce back in a second. Follow us on Twitter at J Church Radio. This is Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Stay with us, folks. Be back in just a second. One. 800-916-6232. That's the number you need to call when you are seeking spiritual enlightenment and searching for your true purpose here on earth. www.lovespellstoday.com. They provide psychic readings, love spells, reversal of spells, custom spells, chakra balancing, energy work. Divine guidance is just one phone call away. Call 1-800-916-6232 for your free psychic reading. I did. And tell them Jimmy sent you.
Hello, I'm Cassidy, and you're listening to my main man, Jimmy Church, on jimmychurchradio.com.
My name's Nick Dominguez.
Hi, I'm Rex Dominguez, and I listen to jimmychurchradio.com. Jimmy is your preacher.
Amen. This is Toby Kebble. You're listening to jimmychurchradio.com.
Don't hurt me, Jimmy. I'm only little.
Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And this is Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers. We're the
yes.
We are of the Honey Brothers. Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And I'm Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers.
And you're listening to Jimmy Church.
The Revolution.
KJCR.
JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Despite popular opinion, reading a book will not make you smarter.
Oh yeah, Fade to Black on the Dark Matter Radio Network. You gotta love it. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Shoot me an email to jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. I think we got Bryce back. Follow us on Twitter at J Church Radio. We got Bryce Zabel live in Berlin. Bryce, are you there? Bryce? I had you. Okay, all right. Well, looks like we still have some Bryce issues. And we are live. I'm showing the connection, so I'm just going to leave it wide open there for a second. Bryce Zabel, we were talking about this very subject, which is, could something like this happen? And Bryce, are you there?
The person whom you're trying to reach is currently unavailable. Please leave a message after the beep.
You gotta love it. Okay, we'll keep the line open, and I am watching the screen, and we will wait for Bryce to come into us. But we were talking about dark skies and the influence and after disclosure and, you know, how the government could possibly influence Hollywood. And I feel that it is, and I feel that there is a tremendous amount of influence. Now the difference is, you know, Bryce is, he's a screenwriter, he's in Hollywood, and he is writing on this subject, and he doesn't feel that the influence is there. And if somebody is doing it, they're doing a really, really bad job. Okay, I think we are getting close. I see the connection, and let's see if he's there. Hold on. Let's see. Bryce, are you there? No? Okay. All right. visually we are connected. Let's try it again. Bryce, are you there?
The person whom you're...
Nope, he is not. That's what you have to do with Berlin. And he's on a line so that I can't take any phone calls coming in on that particular line. So we'll just sit and wait until that comes back. A couple of things that I did want to talk about tonight, and let's get to that. I'm actually looking at the screen and doing a couple of other things at the same time. What I wanted to talk about was, and I was going to do this after we were done with Bryce, I had gotten a bunch of email about hoaxes. And we, over the last couple of weeks, so let's sit and talk about this for a second, about hoaxes. What is a hoax and what isn't a hoax? Can a person be a hoax or not? And I got a bunch of email and asking different questions about people and about stories. And I said, you know what? I did this last week. I said, we're gonna do a hoax special. So next Thursday, I got a couple of emails, oddly enough, about the exact same story. And we're going to cover this next week. Now, I'm going to mention it briefly today. One of the stories is about Linda Napolitano. Now, for everybody out there that is listening and just heard me bring up her name, it's one of the craziest stories. Oh, I think we are connected. Let me try it again. Let me see. Bryce?
I'm back.
Oh,
I'm
there.
Back.
There you are. That was bizarre. But anyway, you're back. And
let me tell you what happened. Apparently, first of all, they were cleaning the Berlin Hotel around me. That was fine. That was a little weird. But then they decided to do an internet check. So they took the whole wireless for the hotel off. They didn't tell me. I'm over here talking in a corner to myself, and it just went away. I can't tell you why they would do that, but they did that.
Okay. Well, you sound great, and you're here, and you're
back.
And again, live radio, we just went to commercial and came back. And
okay.
But and I was just talking about a subject, and it's about hoaxes. And I don't want to let's talk about that for a second. It wasn't anything that I don't plan any conversations, but in the last couple of weeks, the show here just, you know, it's a ship that goes in its own direction, and where it ends up, it ends up. And the conversation with a couple of guests over the last few weeks is it's come around to hoaxes, and not necessarily bad things, but good hoaxes. Hoaxes that we all bought into. And one of them was, and I know you know all about it, the alien autopsy film.
Right.
And a brilliant hoax, well set up. Ray Santilli knew what he was doing from the word go, you know, motivated by money. He took my money. I bought the videotape when it came out. But that's a genuine hoax. And then you have the other hoaxes where somebody is going to make up a story, and so they can go out and sell a couple of books and go out, and they're not making any money, but I think they're doing it because maybe they're lonely, you know, and they just need some attention.
I have to say, I despair at the number of people that are actively hoaxing right now, because this is a really important issue, and it really doesn't help to hoax. I mean, at least, you know, these movies that you mentioned and the ones I've been worked on, they're labeled as movies, and they're not, you know, they're not documentaries, they're movies. But when someone sets out to actually hoax, they just set back things so much. This is already a very difficult topic to get people to dial into and to understand.
Right.
And hoaxes are easier to do than ever before. You can't trust a photo anymore. You barely can trust a video, and that's why, for example, I focus so much on the Roswell case, because at least it's real, it's concrete. These are witness testimonies that you can read and take, and it's not something that's been manufactured in the age of Photoshop. So I wish people that are hoaxing would knock it off. I don't have much respect for the people that do hoax at this point.
Right.
It's not like you're hoaxing the NSA. You know, you're hoaxing people.
Right.
You're hoaxing other people who have a right to know what the truth about this is. And instead of helping, it's a classic from the 60s. Those people that are hoaxing are not part of the solution. They are part of the problem. They are doing the work of disinformation that we like to say the government's doing. You know what? The government doesn't even have to do disinformation anymore. We'll do it through our hoaxing. We'll do it through, frankly, the media product that we're creating. I mean, we do enough we put enough different versions of what reality is out there on our own. But the people who are actually creating hoaxes and putting them on YouTube, knock that stuff off. That's what I say.
Yep, and doing stuff like that for clicks on YouTube so you can get paid. Is just wrong, and some of it is so deliberate. And I look at that where you've got a million views of an obvious CGI job, and in some cases a pretty good CGI job too, I might add. But it is wrong, and
they're great CGI jobs. Some of them,
yeah.
And there's a problem. My son had a friend send him a photo saying that. His mom had captured this image of a UFO over at Malibu. And I got to tell you, it was a great looking photo. It was fantastic. And the craft looked very similar to some that I'd seen from the 60s. And my first impression was, wow, that's a pretty clear photo. I'd like to know who this woman is so that I can talk to her and find out what the circumstances of this sighting were, because this could be a very important photo. Well, what ended up happening is I showed it to my buddy Ben Hansen, and within 1 minute, he sent me back the name of the app that was used to create it. I called the woman and said, "You realize that this photo is a hoax?" And she was offended at me for telling her it was a hoax. Keep in mind, she created it. She used the app. It didn't make itself.
Right.
She created it, but she's offended that I've called her a liar. Well, she was a liar. She was perpetrating a hoax, and she was passing a photo around using her son to do it.
Right.
And certainly was hoping to get in the papers or something. And it's just a freaking app that anybody can get for their iPhone.
Because of your position and people that know who you are. Oh, you know what? I'm gonna remember. Hold on. I got to tell you what happened the other day. So you and I were talking on the phone when I was at the DMV earlier this week, right?
Yes.
And I was there with my daughter. She's getting her driver's license. And I'm in line at the DMV. But this is Hollywood for you. I'm in line, and you and I are talking on the phone, and I pick, and I've got the loudest voice in the world, and I can't control it. It is what it is. But I go, "Oh, Bryce Zabel. Yeah, Jimmy Church." And you and I started talking. We did our thing. And I hang up the phone. And in fact, you said, "I'll call you back in a second, Jimmy. Let me check on one thing. I'm going to call you right back." Then you call back, and I'm like, "Hey, Bryce, okay." Well, and then we hang up the guy in back of me in line taps me on the shoulder. And he goes, "Is that Bryce Zabel, the guy that did Dark Skies?" And I go, "What?" And I turn around. He goes, He's a great guy. "Hey, man, I've got a screenplay I'm working on."
Oh, my God.
"I'm not on All That I Love, Bryce." On All That I Love. And this guy watched me at the DMV. I could tell he was about to go out to his car, because he just got back from Kinko's. And he's going to hit me. But anyway, how crazy is that?
The thing is, though, we live in a mass media society. I've been gratified at the number of people that have seen Dark Skies. And I don't mean to, I'm glad the guy's writing. I don't actually read anybody else's screenplays about anything for a lot of reasons. But particularly in the world of UFOs, I wouldn't read them because, that's my specialty.
And right.
I've got enough of my own material I'm trying to find a home for, so I don't read it. But I know that people are, let's face it, why are people writing this stuff? They're writing it because they're thinking of it. It's on their consciousness. People know a lot about this topic, but there is a lot of misinformation. I mean, it's interesting, and you know, I feel like I've dug myself into a hole that we should talk about something else, but
right.
There's misinformation and there's disinformation.
Right.
Misinformation is what we're doing to ourselves. Disinformation is what the government might possibly be doing. I think that at the very beginning of this whole thing, coming out of World War II, disinformation is what allowed us to pull off the D-Day invasion without the Germans knowing where we were coming.
Right.
That was a valid kind of disinformation, and the very things that they learned during the World War II experience allowed the late 40s and 50s people who were dealing with the UFO topic to bring about official disinformation to sort of twist the story a little bit.
Right.
But my opinion is that over the years, the secret keepers have had to do a whole lot less work because we're willing to do it for them. And this goes back, frankly, you know, from the 50s, and it kind of kicked up in the 60s and 70s, and now it's a cottage industry, as you point out on YouTube.
Right.
So we're getting, if we could cut the misinformation out, it would be really helpful. But I have no hope that that will happen.
Well, you know, they learn how to, you know, to steer us like lemmings to the sea, you know, and found out that it's actually easier than, and they learned all of those lessons in World War II. You're absolutely right on that. Have you ever had, now that people, speaking of people knowing who you are, like at the line at the DMV, has anybody come up to you with anything really cool, like pulled you to the side and said, you know, check this out, man, here's some info, or here's this, or here's this.
Well, that's what happened at Dark Skies. We were visited. Well, let me put it this way, I don't want to fall completely in the hole, but we had a Dark Skies premiere party at my house. And so the entire cast and crew was at the house to sort of celebrate the show premiering. And literally, there was one guy that crashed the party who nobody knew who he was, and I was too busy hosting, but he corralled my partner and one of the guys on our writing staff, and basically said that he was part of Naval Intelligence, and that they wanted to help us fix our show.
No.
Yeah, that happened. But the thing is, here's without going into all the details of what followed subsequent to that, the fact that he said he was from Naval Intelligence does not prove that he's from Naval Intelligence.
That's right.
He may very well have just been another one of these hoaxers who thought, how fun it will be to crash the Dark Skies party, and I'll see how naive these guys are and what I can float on them. So the only thing that made me believe that it might be more truthful is that there was a deep amount of knowledge that the guy had, but about the topic, but he also had some knowledge about the show. He had read the script. And he said, well, you know, we've read your script and we think it's really good, but we think, you know, we'd like to help you fix the show.
Did he look like, without getting too many details, because it sounds like it's a private experience too, but I do have to ask, I wouldn't be doing my job if I didn't. Did he look official? Did he impress you as, I mean, I'm talking to first vision.
Yeah, he was a lean, you know, young guy that could have been in that job. I mean, he obviously didn't show up in a uniform. He came to he crashed a house party.
Right.
So he was in a blue blazer and khaki slacks, I think. And then later, a meeting was set up at the Dark Skies offices. I didn't want to have anything to do with this guy. You know, I mean, I think it's pretty creepy to crash somebody's house. We agreed to meet him at the Dark Skies office with lots of people around and with our security people, and he brought a guy, and they talked to us for a couple of hours, and it was full of information that, you know, I couldn't check out, you know, that sounded really interesting, but it was ultimately hard to check out. And at the end of the thing, we wanted proof, and the proof he said he would offer came with such a price of insecurity, I would say, that I ended up saying, you know what, this meeting's over. You know, I've got a family, and I'm not putting my family at risk for, you, who I don't know who you are, and I've got a network that doesn't want me solving the UFO problem by talking to everybody who claims to be somebody important, and I need to put a show on. So I threw him out of the office.
And so obviously he didn't have, he wasn't wearing tinfoil on his head. So
he was a very credible person.
Very credible person.
But you know, many of those videos are very credible looking. It's hard to say. It's really hard to say.
Any further contact with this gentleman? Or
No. What he wanted us to do is he wanted us to meet somebody in Long Beach at midnight, okay, in a cemetery. I'm not kidding. And I said, when he said that, I just said, well, this conversation's over. I'm done. We're not having any. You're excused. Goodbye. I'm going back to work. I'm certainly not meeting any Mr. Big at midnight in a cemetery in Long Beach.
Right.
I mean, that just sounds crazy. It sounds crazy to say it to you now, and yet that's what the guy told us.
Well, you write about the subject matter that you do, and you're going to, there's going to be somebody that needs that release somehow to, and go through you. That sounds like obviously, if it would have been official, you'd have been contacted and wouldn't.
Absolutely. In a way that was incontrovertible and it would have been clear. That hasn't happened to me, and I don't know of anyone that it's happened to. At the same time, it put me off those kind of contacts. I have a private life. I expect that I should be able to live it without having that kind of stuff going on, and so I discourage it whenever I can.
Or you could be the disinformation guy right now.
Well, that's what people said. It's funny. I mean, that shows how twisted the sort of the pretzel logic of all this has become, because it's true. People could say that and have said that. That makes me laugh. It's not true. But once you go down the rabbit hole and say, well, that's exactly how they would do it, then anything is fair game. And I've used that dramatically. I mean, certainly Dark Skies and all my UFO cover-up stuff, you want to use that stuff to say, well, if you were really trying to keep it secret, then you would do this. And they would, of course, deny it, which would only prove that it was true.
Exactly. Exactly. And you could do this almost every day on any subject in this field. You can reverse it 180 degrees all the time.
At the end of the day, though, and this takes me into after disclosure, at the end of the day, while I am a big proponent of the fact that there is an awful lot of noise to a lot less signal when it comes to evidence.
Sure.
The evidence is still strong to me that there is a core reality that we've missed, at least publicly, in a wide-ranging way, and that at some point something is going to break that dam. And all the television shows and films books and fakes and hoaxes will be swept away by a demand to know what the real truth is, because we will have disclosed this reality to ourselves. In other words, for the last 70 years, it's been more a matter of when are they going to tell us?
Right.
We are increasingly, with our sophisticated technology, coming to the place where we are going to be able to disclose to ourselves in an incontrovertible way. And when that happens, for example, guys like me, if anything, we won't be selling fake alien movies. They'll be actually asking us to create movies based on fact, because the public will have a thirst to know what's really going on, which, by the way, is why a couple of the projects that I'm working on and that I'm here talking to people about, the ones close to my heart is Majic Men, M-A-J-I-C, Majic 12, because I think it's time to create some new things in the genre instead of, when you mentioned those 50 names of all the different alien things,
right.
I don't think anybody thinks Transformers 4 is going to be a real movie about what's really going on.
Right.
It's going to be an interesting Michael Bay movie, but it's not going to be about what's really going on. And I think there's got to be room for some stories that are told now to be more like the Fire in the Sky genre, although it had its problems, but but something based on a ufologically true event.
Right.
I tried to do that with Dark Skies, and Majic Men will clearly be in that world, where it tells the story of Stanton Friedman and Don Schmidt and the competition they had between themselves to break the Roswell story.
Well, let's talk about Majic Men. I was, you know, that was one of the things. Now, I haven't had Schmidt on the show. Would love to have him on the show. I've had Stanton on. A great guy, by the way. Love what he's done. And Stanton, to me, over the years, he's like everybody's dad in this industry.
Right.
You know, we all look up to him. He's guided us all. We look to him for honesty, for hard work. We all do. And it's, you know what? He's just the guy that you want to trust. You know, he's got that.
He's a great guy. But, you know, from my point of view, I got to know both Stan Friedman and Don Schmidt when I was doing Dark Skies. And they both obviously have done prodigious and good work in breaking the Roswell story. But there was a period in the 90s where Stan and Don were at each other's throats.
Absolutely.
Where they were calling each other names, and they had supporters calling each other's names. And so even as they were sort of racing the Undertaker to get the story broken, they were also bedeviled by all these human politics. And I found that to be the interesting way to tell this story, kind of the spoonful of sugar. It's a character drama about Stan and Don that allows me to sort of feed people the rest of the story, which is what really happened at Roswell. And so I optioned both Stan's book, Top Secret Magic, and Don's book, Witness to Roswell, and also their two life stories, and I put them together into Majic Men, which I hope will, if I can get it made, and again, that's a big if, but if I can get it made, I hope it will have the same kind of impact that JFK did, that where the people leave the theater and instead of saying, "So tell me what's going on with your kids," they end up saying to each other, "My God, is that real?" Because if it's real, it changes everything.
Yeah, totally. And with you can almost compare Roswell to Dark Skies, but let me.
Did Roswell in Dark Skies in our first episode.
But let me, give me 30 seconds here.
Sure.
Just give me 30 seconds for this pitch. But
yes,
what if Roswell, what if the government didn't clamp it down for another 24 hours? What if they lost control? Because they lost control of the story in the beginning when the newspaper and the radio reports got out. But what if, with all of the racing of cars to Roswell, New Mexico, with every journalist and radio guy in the country is trying to get there to get the story, and what if history was just 24 hours different?
Well, I got to tell you, I'm writing that book right now.
Okay.
My first book, as you know, I'm doing an Alt-Worlds trilogy of books. The first book is the one that's out now, Surrounded by Enemies, What If Kennedy Survived Dallas?
Right.
Which, by the way, if people want to read it, it's on sale at a special, it's only $2.99 on Amazon for the ebook, and it's you can go to surroundedbyenemies.com and read it.
Okay,
follow-up book to it is a little more whimsical. It's called Across the Other Universe, What If the Beatles Stayed Together? But the third book is called In the Shadow of the Saucers, What If Truman Disclosed Roswell? And that's exactly the premise that you just laid out, that they don't get on top of it right away. And Truman has to fess up, and it changes the 50s, as you can imagine, pretty radically.
Well, and like I said, we were, you know, if not hours, you know, minutes away from that whole story spinning way out of control.
Yeah, I mean, that's exactly what's always intrigued me, was what a close call with the truth it was. Of course, it's fanciful now. I mean, it belongs in my Alt-World series. It's a what if. It's not a what happened. The what happened of Majic Men is what intrigues me. I mean, when I look at Roswell and the work that Stan Friedman and Don Schmidt have done, is it's a giant mosaic that they've assembled. There isn't one person who says, "Well, I was there. I did this. I did that. And here's the memo, and here's the photos, and here's the video, and, you know, there's no one person, okay? Instead, there's like 300 people
right.
who have all seen their little piece of it, and when you take all the pieces together, you see that there is a reality to the situation, that there's something that happened there that certainly wasn't a weather balloon. And also, a lot of these deathbed confessions, think about it. Nobody on their deathbed has ever confessed to it being a weather balloon. You know, the people on their deathbeds tell their families it was a flying saucer. There were alien bodies.
Right.
That's what they confess on their deathbeds.
Right.
If you look at what the law says about deathbed confessions, the law treats a deathbed confession very, very carefully. It has a lot of value in a court proceeding, and there's probably dozens of them now from Roswell.
This is an opinion of yours, but I want your opinion. But when you have, by all accounts, hundreds of military people on the ground at the crash site, you know, elbow to elbow, picking up debris, going across, and you have a couple of, where is that documentation of the orders of sending those troops there? All of those guys, there's no way that everybody was silenced.
No, they weren't. And in fact, I mean, one of the things that that Stan and Don have discovered is that all of the files from that period that are supposed to, by law, be kept.
Right.
Are gone.
Right.
There's a whole year and a half missing of various communications from the Roswell area. And, you know, the government just kind of shrugs and says, you know what, it just happened. It's not nefarious like you think. We just lost track of everything.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I would submit that that's probably not a true statement.
When you started to put together Majic Men, and you've known Stanton for a long time, when you hold those documents in your hand and in totality, I mean, obviously you're not holding the real ones, but when you're holding those and you're looking through what's your gut tell you, you know, some of them aren't real. We know that. I mean, they all can't be
right.
real. If they're all real, we've got a real, real problem on our hands, what's your gut say? What side of the fence are you on?
On the documents themselves? Listen, that's a complicated question. I will say that we need to define the 1984 documents as a separate collection of documents from the sort of the flood that came out in the 2000s that I'm not going to speculate about. I mean, and they both have problems in terms of how they came to be public. Particularly, let's go to the 84 ones. There's a lot that really, I mean, the idea that Donald Menzel is listed as one of the members of Majestic 12 at first looked like something that was undermining to the credibility of those documents. But in reality, it turns out that he had a high security clearance and
right.
would have been exactly the kind of person.
Right.
So I have to go with Stan. I think that those documents are probably real, but they were revealed in a somewhat shady way that undermines them a little bit. But I give a lot of credit to Stan for being dogged in his determination to track them down. And in a way, those documents are helpful in seeing the whole Roswell environment. And I guess at the end of the day, if I had to handicap some percentage of the fact that they might not be the actual real documents, then they're somebody's attempt to spin what really happened anyway. I mean, they came in a very specific way, and they have a lot of specific information in them. And Stan is, who I think is a very bright man, has done a pretty great job of lending credibility to them. So I'm going to go with the documents.
Are those two?
But before I start getting a lot of, you know, mail about that, you don't have to believe the documents are real to believe that Roswell represents an event that is a crash of something that is not man-made. So whether the documents are 100% real or a percentage real or not real at all, it doesn't undermine the reality of Roswell as an extraordinary event.
Did those two ever kiss and make up?
They have now, but they were really at odds. The biggest thing I had when I spent so much time with them interviewing them in preparation to write the film was that they each would tell me, "Oh no, Stan's a great." Don would say Stan's a great guy, and Stan would say Don's a great guy, and I'd say, "But didn't you guys fight about the?" "Oh no, that's nothing." And I just had to keep digging. And the more I dug and the more I cross-referenced, I mean, they had a pretty big rift. Anyone who knew about the whole UFO movement in those days knows that those two guys were at it, hammer and tongs. And so what I've tried to do is, and also there's the age difference. So there's a bit of a mentor-mentee possibility.
Sure.
There's also the idea that at a certain point, Don steps out of the shadow that Stan Friedman is casting and takes it on his own. And in reality, you know, Stan is an older man now and is probably slowing down in his pursuit, whereas Don is truly on fire right now.
Right.
He is continuing his work. He's one of the heart. And he's – but they're both I will say this. For a story that's out of this world, these are two very down-to-earth people who are flawed human beings, and that's what makes the movie great.
Well, I will say this about I haven't had Don on the show, but I've had Stanton on, and when I contacted him, he literally responded back within 5 minutes. "How you doing, Jimmy?" "Absolutely, yeah, sure." You know, and I was like, "Wow." Well, he did the same thing to me. I think we talked about this on the show. But this is how Stanton is. Years ago, 94, 95, I contacted him with Internet 1.0, you know, whatever email program I was using back then, and contacted him, and he contacted me back, and we had a little brief little thing. But here's a guy, back then when things were blowing up, just like you're saying, he found the time to talk to a nobody here, you know, in California.
And he's a great guy, and he does want to – he learns things by talking to nobodies, and you aren't a nobody. But he – like Jesse Marcel was a nobody when Stan talked to him, but he turned out not to be one at all. I do think Stan's, by the way, a great character, because here's a guy who is trying to crack the Roswell case. He was one of the last adopters of a cell phone – or a laptop,
right?
You know, he didn't have any of this technology,
right? Right.
I mean, he had a phone service, not a cell phone.
Right.
He didn't have a laptop. He had a bunch of Xerox copies that he carted around with him.
Right.
You know, fascinating character study.
Well, when I'm assuming that the screenplay is done, you're just waiting for funding. You know,
well,
you ready?
You know what I'm.
Because I want to ask you about the story, and so sure. Is it done?
Here's how I would put it about a story, is no story is done until they shoot it, and even then you can reshoot it. So okay. The first draft is done, the draft that I hope will represent something close to what we finally shoot. But even for myself, I'm not done. I mean, I'm going to continue to evaluate it until we actually shoot it. I mean, that's what you do in TV. You're making changes to the last minute. I assume we'll do the same on the script. But the overall concept of the script is clear, and it's a really good script. I like it, but I'm sure it will evolve as it goes into development. And you know, let's face it, it's going to be an expensive film to make. So somebody, I don't have the money to make this film myself, so I'm not going to be paying for it. So somebody who is going to be paying for it is going to have their own opinions about how it ought to be made.
Well, because I'm asking more of a historical timeline on how things went down. There was the second race to Roswell. The first one happened in 1947 with all the journalists. But then the next one happened when Marcel came forward with the story.
1978.
Yeah, 1978.
He took Stan Friedman the story, yeah.
And how did Schmidt find out?
Well, Schmidt, let's see.
And that's why I'm asking, how far along is it developed, and have you thought about it in those terms? So when did
Yes, absolutely. One of the things that I did, and I've done it going back to Dark Skies, is I always create timelines that show concurrent events. So, for example, on Dark Skies, we created a three-part timeline. One of them was UFO events, and one was events from that we pulled from Time and Newsweek magazine, and the other was Dark Skies' interpretation of these events. And so, when things lined up, we had an episode. For example, when a UFO was sighted at the same time as the power blackout, that became an episode. So I brought the timeline idea to Stan and Don. I interviewed them both for, God, forever, it seemed like. Took prodigious notes, put Don's notes and Stan's notes into timelines, broke down their books into the same timeline, and tried to see where things matched up and all that. But keep in mind, Don is not the, you know, Stan is the original Roswell researcher. He broke the story.
Right.
And then a lot of other people started getting into it. And also, and this is part of the movie, Stan got somewhat distracted by his pursuit of the Majestic 12 documents, and he created a vacuum in the Roswell investigation. He didn't give it up entirely, but he put so much of his energy. A man's only got so much energy on a volunteer basis.
Right.
So he put his energy into the Majestic 12 documents, which created the vacuum that Don Schmidt and his partner at the time, Kevin Randall, were able to, take over. And so that's where the competition really began. And then it got really arcane. It's like people debating how many landing sites and where were they and whether this witness was a good witness or a bad witness. And each guy had their own witnesses that they were pushing. And, you know, and the thing is that they were both right and both wrong at various times. And only as we've sort of fallen into the future here has the consensus started to make itself clear about the Roswell timeline of events, but it's still a little murky. I mean, I don't think anybody can tell you down this is what happened precisely this way. What you can say is that the recollections are sufficient that you know it happened, but you know, people are bad. If I ask you what happened last Thursday, you're not going to be completely accurate right now.
If I ask you what happened
Thursday in 1947, you're probably going to say I wasn't born. But if you ask someone who was alive back then, they're going to say, you know, I mean, that they might get the week wrong. You know, they might say, you might say to a witness, well, was it around the 4th of July? And they'll go, well, people have failing memories, particularly as they age. So one of the things that is so great about what Stan and Don have done is to actually work very hard to get people on the record. And I commend them for that.
Do you think that with all of the attention that Roswell, the town itself, had suddenly started to receive in the mid-90s, it didn't happen immediate, but from 78 forward, you have a 30-40 year quiet period there where nothing's going on, but suddenly this attention is focused on the town. Do you think that maybe a simple event, there's no doubt that something happened there, and that a craft of some kind came down, and it wasn't a weather balloon. I think we all can come to that conclusion. But do you think that with all of this attention, that as Stanton is there researching, and Schmidt is there, and Kevin Randall, and not only them, but everybody else seemed to have been writing a book too as well. Now, do you think that it maybe took on a life of its own, and some of it just wasn't true and made up, and you know?
People probably exaggerated. Yeah. Some people weren't great witnesses, but the same is true of the Kennedy assassination. You know, has anybody completely nailed exactly how it went down?
No. Right.
But is it largely true now that most people would agree that there was some kind of conspiracy to kill Jack Kennedy.
Right.
I think that's probably true. I think you've got the same similar kind of situation with Roswell.
Right.
And you're right. I mean, people want to I've encountered this over and over. As a journalist, I would routinely have people lie to me because they wanted to get on the air, or they had a spin they wanted to make. I mean,
right.
So that's going to happen. But the overwhelming number of witnesses are decent military guys
mm-hmm.
who talk about an important time in their lives that they've suppressed for years and have told their families about, sometimes reluctantly. And many of these witnesses did so without a desire for fame. Many of them told their story and said, please don't use my name. Many of them told their story only when they knew they were dying. Many of them didn't want to tell their story because they thought their families would not be beneficiaries of their pensions. So I think these witnesses are pretty good people.
Do you, when, and I don't want to be so direct in what I am trying to suggest, because the majority are good people, and I don't want to insinuate that it's completely out of control and it's epidemic, but not everybody in Roswell handled that metal and wrinkled it up like tinfoil. You know, and it just seems to me that, and then suddenly it wasn't one crash, it was three, it was five, it was 20, and they're, you know, and somebody else is writing a book, so then they come to town. And, I mean, do you find in your research, do you have to just, like, start to ignore certain situations?
Well, I think that that's a problem, but I think that the way you stated it is the exaggeration of the problem. There is consensus on a lot of specific facts, and the witnesses who get the greater credibility obviously are your military witnesses, and you know, not all witnesses are equal, and there are people over time who have tried to pretend that they were more than they were, and those people have been vetted and thrown out of the witness pool. So there's been good work done trying to narrow it down, and I think that there's is there an attempt on the part of witnesses from time to time to want to inflate their testimony to look better? Yes. I mean, ask any lawyer. They'll tell you that.
Right.
But does that account for literally creating a story about an extraterrestrial craft crashing in Roswell? Not really.
Right.
I mean, those were the stories that were coming out, you know, from the beginning. I give you an example. You know, Edgar Mitchell, who was the pilot of Apollo 14, who I consider to be one of the bravest men around, because think about it, Apollo 13 almost killed everybody.
Right.
So he was the first guy up after Apollo 13 crapped out.
Yep.
And he landed on the moon. So he was a brave guy. This guy grew up in Roswell. And he came back to Roswell after he was a national hero for the moon landing, and he had all kinds of people in Roswell coming up to him and saying, hey, Edgar, you got to do something about what happened here back in the 40s. You got to get this out. So, you know, this was before Jesse Marcel had spoken out. And Edgar Mitchell, who I consider to be a very credible guy, clearly says that Roswell was the crash of an extraterrestrial craft, from what he knows.
In a strange way, you and Richard Dolan are kind of like that torchbearer too as well. When you guys go and you write something like AD and you write a book like that, which is straight to the point, it is not messing around, it's not conjecture, the point that you're trying to convey is right there on the cover of the book. Did you like have to brace yourself for the reaction out of Washington, and were you prepared for that?
I don't know, but let me first just say, writing AD After Disclosure with Richard Dolan was one of the most enjoyable experiences of my writing career, because there was a 6-month period where Richard and I would call each other about every day and go, what do you think would happen if?
Right.
What about? And we have these conversations that were fascinating. And the one thing that AD tries to do is it does have certain facts that we try to lay out there. But the other thing we tried to do, and I think I tried to bring, you know, let's face it, Richard is I think he is the best historian of UFOs working today. And I'm not that. His depth of knowledge is deeper than mine. But what I am is a dramatist. So I tried to say, how can we talk about how the future might look once disclosure happens? So I did a lot of that. And it was a fascinating kind of combination. Flawed sometimes, but I think it's a pretty strong. We felt that we had to write that book because we both realized when we first met that it was the book we both wanted to read, but nobody had written it. So we decided to write it. And again, for your listeners who are wondering why we call it AD, well, obviously after disclosure, but we feel that the disclosure of the UFO reality is so extreme that it literally is the dividing time in our calendar of the modern era, that everything before disclosure will be BC, before confirmation. Right. And everything after disclosure will be AD. And they may not physically change the calendar to reflect that. We still may stick with the birth of Jesus, or maybe not. But it's definitely that kind of event. It's a huge event, and it's going to rattle everybody's cages.
Now that the book is out and you've had time to reflect back, let me ask you a couple of questions directly.
Sure.
How do you feel now? Like I said, the book is out. You've had your reaction. You've talked enough about it. How do you think the public, not the government, the public in general, what do you think the reaction would be?
Of disclosure itself? Well, actually, it's kind of interesting. I do hope that I believe the book was read by people that are in charge of keeping the secret. And I hope we directly write to some of them. And I hope they take it to heart, and I hope they move up their plans. But what do I really think will happen? I think the best way that I could explain how it's going to go down is first to say that I don't know the actual core underlying reality. I only know that some serious messed up stuff is probably waiting to be revealed. So it's going to be shocking in ways that I can't 100% understand right now, and probably very few people can. But what I think is going to happen, the best analogy I can give you is it's going to be like the 1960s all over again. We're going to have the 60s are going to happen again. I mean, a 60s with technology, you know, a 60s of in a turbulent way that I'm referring to, and it's something we have to go through. It's sort of Buck Turgeson in Dr. Strangelove. He's talking about a nuclear weapon going off. He says, "Well, I ain't saying we're not going to get our hair messed."
Yeah,
and that's what I think is going to happen. I mean, it's going to mess our hair up a little bit. It's going to be at least 10 years from disclosure till some degree of return to normalcy. You know, for at least 10 years, people are going to be in motion in ways that I don't think they have been since the 1960s. So I look for the 60s the spirit of the 60s to take over again.
That's a good way to look.
Good and bad ways.
Well, that's a positive spin, but I agree.
That's also a negative one. The 60s had Vietnam and the Kennedy assassination.
Well, you know, the pandemonium, the religious turmoil, the upheaval, the anarchy, the lawlessness, you know, the panic, you know, the implosion of everything. That's what I don't think is going to happen. I just don't.
You know what, though? I'm not saying, neither Richard or I are saying that the decade is going to be marked with that. That's why we picked AD. You can do AD day one, AD week one, AD month one.
What we're really
saying is there's going to be, I'm not saying there's going to be anarchy. I think there's going to be disturbance and some chaos for a while for the simple reason that, like, if the guy who delivers the milk to your local store, you know, stays home to watch TV for a week because he's freaking out, well, then you don't get milk in your store, and pretty soon people are standing in lines and freaking out that the shelves at Costco are empty. Okay, I'm saying there will be that kind of disturbance in the short term. What I'm arguing is in the long term, you get that sort of societal reevaluation of what's important and what's not, and what's really going on with the world, and what how we should be conducting ourselves as people. That's all. That's what I think the 60s was. So when I say the 60s, I mean social upheaval and reevaluation and sort of thinking about how to do things differently and conflicting with people about what should be done next. That's the 60s to me. That's when I say we're going to have another 60s after disclosure. That's what I mean. I'm not talking about, you know, I don't, yeah, you might have martial law, you know, in the first couple of weeks when deliveries aren't being made. But as long as the others, whoever these others are, you know, don't land on the White House lawn or vaporize the White House, you're not going to have that kind of crazy panic.
Right. I wanted to ask you really quick, and I hope that you'll stay on for another segment or two, because there's a couple of other things that we have 100% neglected. But okay. I want to tell everybody, on the if you go to jimmychurchradio.com right now, go to the homepage, just scroll down, and we have a little Bryce Zabel gallery, and it's there. And but Bryce, you sent me your own MJ-12 document, the letter,
the Lone Guard letter.
Yes, yeah. And so I want everybody, before you tell me what it is, I think it's really cool, by the way. I don't have of the piles of paperwork in this house. I don't have anything like this. This is really cool. But there's so everybody, just go down to the bottom of the page. Go to the gallery at jimmychurchradio.com. Bryce Zabel Gallery. In the third row, you'll see it. There's only one letter in that group of pictures. Click on that, open it up, and then, Bryce, what am I looking at here? What is this?
This is a letter. well, the main character of Dark Skies is a character named John Lonegard, played by Eric Close. The letter you're reading is a letter that Brent Friedman and I received from, well, the letter basically is from someone saying, if you want to get the truth out, you have to use the cover of fiction so that people don't get hurt. So this is sort of the inciting incident of Dark Skies. Dark Skies is meant to be a little interactive in that regard. And the idea was that someone claiming to be part of the cover-up had contacted Brent and myself, suggested that we try to create a television series that would allow, as a vehicle, to get some of the truth out of what had really transpired, and that we gave him the name John Lonegard, and then he wrote us that letter.
I'm going to read it because it's really cool. It says, you know, Bryce and Brent dated January 2nd, 1995, but it says, "The truth must be told. You have been chosen as instruments to achieve this objective. The truth, however, must not be represented as truth. Too many people are needed in the struggle, will die. The cover of fiction must be used to present this truth. Those who fear the light will not want to bring attention to you by allowing your death. This is the only way. Do not be afraid. The fight for humanity demands your courage." And that isn't that exactly what we've been talking about?
Well, the yes. Yeah. It's part of the history of the show. I have a lot of feelings about that letter. Obviously, the person who wrote it has a sense of theatrics and drama. It's a little overboiled for my taste, but it is an interesting letter to have received from someone, and I don't hide it. I just share it.
You know, again, everybody, go check it out, jimmychurchradio.com. It's right there. Scroll to the bottom of the page. It's there. And we're at the top of the hour. I want to take a quick break. I want to take a breather. And then I want to come back, and I want to spend some time on Kennedy. I want to get into that. And possibly, if you'll stay with us, I want to talk about Betty and Barney Hill. Okay, are you down for that, sir?
I'm down. Let's do it.
Okay, man. What time is it in Berlin?
I don't have any freaking idea. I know it's still a little dark out. So right around the time that you're trundling off to bed, it'll be light, and I'll be going out to a local bakery for coffee.
Don't be jealous. I'm jealous of you. We'll be back right after this. More with Bryce Zabel on the Dark Matter Radio Network. This is Faded Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Stay with us. We'll be back right after this.
What's up? My name's Brian Taylor, ninja badass extraordinaire, and this is JimmyChurchRadio.com.
JJCR in your face.
JimmyChurchRadio.com
on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
All right, everybody, welcome back. I'm your host, Jimmy Church, live on the Dark Matter Radio Network. Fade to black. Shoot me some email to jimmy@jimmychurchradio.com. This is live radio, Bryce. This is live, and you're in Berlin. You got to love technology. I'm here. We sound like we're sitting next to each other in the same room, and I'm forgetting to stop my bumper music. And, you know, again, live radio. But I just got an email, just came in, and I was reading it during the break. Now, I'm going to read this live, and again, this is just live radio. You know, nobody's going to get sued here. But I just read the opening line on this, so I'm going to do this live. It says,
go for it.
Jimmy and Bryce. Okay, so it's sent to the both of us. Sounds like we all agree on the harm hoaxers do to the field of ufology. Why would either of you want to give a forum to Don Schmidt, a guy who lied about his background and pedigree? Is claiming credentials he didn't have a hoax in your mind? And we were just talking about that earlier, so let's answer that. Even a hack like Kevin Randall distanced himself from Schmidt. Okay.
And it's a good question.
Let me finish.
I thought it was done.
Yeah, exactly. Well, he goes on to say, seems to me ufology and politics are only careers where an individual can be totally discredited yet still progress in their chosen fields. Yes, he's right about that. Feel free to use this comment on air, including my titles below, but not my name or location. Okay. Well, this guy is an aviation engineer, an aviation historian. And so there you go. Okay, I didn't use his name. But, okay, go ahead. You first. I'll answer.
I have to use my name. I think the person should sign his name, you know, frankly. But, why does anybody get a pass on making statements and not saying who they are?
Right.
I don't buy that. But I will say that Majic Men deals with the controversy about Don Schmidt's background and also his conflict with his partner and so forth. It does it through dramatic license and, you know, to combine it into stand story, etc. But those things are dealt with. Those are real issues. Don has explanations for some of the things that he did or that were done, and they're part of the film. And as I said, the concept of the film is these flawed individuals who rise to try to tell this story, regardless of the costs to their own personal lives, etc. And I don't think either man would argue that their obsession with Roswell has been anything that's a picnic for their lives and their lifestyles. So you know, I hope to do justice to exactly what the writer is talking about.
Right.
I don't think it I think that Don made a pretty, you know, got caught in a pretty major situation. But who among us, who among your listeners hasn't had a personal problem or something go on that if it was public wouldn't embarrass them?
Oh, I've got way too many.
Yeah, me too. And but and I'm sure most of your listeners do. So Don has things to account for, and he's held to account in the film for those things as well. He's a character in a film about Roswell, and it would be improper in a movie about breaking the Roswell story to not deal with him, because he's a very important person who has continued to research this.
Right.
And,
right.
You know, I think you have to look at the research. You know, the it's true. People have conflicted. Stan and Don have conflicted about their research methods. Don has conflicted with partners about it. He made up with Kevin Randall more recently, and now I don't know what their relationship is now. It's not part of the film. But, you know, listen, it's a fair comment. Hopefully the final film will address it in a way that even the writer will feel good about.
Well, and I know why, well, partially why, you know, an email like this would come in. On this show, what I haven't and I will not do is just get somebody on this show where there is a question of pedigree and resume. I'm just not going to do that. But what I have, what my position is, a lucky one, in that I can look back at history and I am able to pick and choose who is legitimate, you know, has a resume that speaks for themselves. Too many times in the past, and this is what this guy is referring to in his email, where people have been allowed a platform where they have claimed stuff on their background, education or otherwise, that turned out to be completely fictitious and not true. And
yes,
and they haven't been vetted at all. Me,
right, but I would argue Don Schmidt has been held accountable for his resume inflation,
right,
and faced a rather chilling decision for him. He could go hide and give it all up and say, well, that's that.
Right.
Or he could suck it up and say, yeah, that pretty well sucked, and I pretty well did that to myself.
Right.
And I still care about this issue. And, you know, as a decision, I'm going to continue to look into it because that's who I am.
Right.
And, you know, who among us is capable of, you know, we can judge him. In terms of holding him accountable, and I do. I've you know, when I said I've talked to these guys, I've spent a long time haranguing Don Schmidt about various things that happened, and I've cross-referenced him with Stan, and I've harangued Stan about things because I've been trying to get at the basic truth between the two guys. But at the end of the day, what I want Majic Men as a film to do is not necessarily be the perfect representation of Stan and Don as, you know, if you want to know more about them, you can meet them or read about them or read their books. I want to get the Roswell story told through these witnesses. So the one thing that I do I take dramatic license in the film script, but I don't take dramatic license, to the best of my knowledge, with the witness testimony. I'm trying to hold firm on that as being exactly what one of these witnesses has told to either Stan or Don.
Well, and you would have to. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. You would have to do that. With what I wanted to touch upon a little bit, this is it's not about me, but right now I'm going to make it about me. I listen to, when I curl up at night and I fall asleep to the radio, AM radio. That's what I do. And also, you know, I'll fall asleep to some YouTube radio show from years past. And I was listening to this week a couple of Yahoos, two guys that just neither of them, one is a radio host and the other one is his guest. And neither of these guys are telling the truth. It was the craziest thing to ever listen to, where I'm not going to say who I was listening to, but I'm just thinking to myself, this is the exact opposite of how I want to live my life.
Right.
But yet these two guys, they know that the other guy isn't telling the truth. The guest knows that the host is just way out there with his statements. The guest is even going further, and the two of them are feeding off of each other, and they both know they're not. They're lying.
that's not good. I mean, I have to say, I think that people that portray themselves as truth revealers have to be held to a good standard. So I do agree with you, and I agree with your listener who wrote the comment that they have to be held accountable. Myself, I've had a really kind of odd time with it. I started as a journalist, but then when I became a dramatist, I mean, I have to be able to dramatize events. Those aren't lies. Those are, you know, that's the drama of what I'm telling.
Right.
It's a different kind of thing.
Is it difficult to do? I mean, as a journalist, where, you know, it's all about fact checking, triple fact checking.
I don't hold myself out to be the world's authority on the facts of UFOs. I hold myself out to be a relatively informed dramatist on it. I will let people like Richard Dolan, who write about it, and Don and Stan, and frankly, all the other, Leslie Kane, other great people who have written about it, I'll let their writing stand for the journalistic aspect of it. And, you know, I'll just do the best I can to get it as right as I can when I can. But at the end of the day, when I'm pitching something in Hollywood or trying to make a movie, you know, I'm not making a documentary. If I was making a documentary, that would be a different standard. Mm-hmm. If I'm making the Majic Men is not actually based on the lives of these people. It's inspired by the lives of these people. You know, and when people want to know more, if the movie comes out, if they see them, you know, if they can go read their books.
Let's, you know? Can we talk about Kennedy for a second?
Sure, please. I love Kennedy.
Now, you sent me a photograph, by the way. I just want to start off with that. You sent me a photograph of Kennedy with a cigar.
Yeah.
Why that picture? Because it's a great picture.
It's one of my favorite Kennedy pictures. You know, Kennedy just had style and grace and cool, and it allowed him... he was a man's man, but he was also a woman's man. You know, I mean, he really had it all. And I've been compelled by him dramatically with Dark Skies, where he literally was the character behind the scenes. And in this latest book, Surrounded by Enemies, What If Kennedy Survived Dallas? That picture. I don't know. I just sent it to you. I don't have a good answer to your question other than I liked it. Well, I sent it, I think, because it makes me – that's the guy who you need to understand existed when you read Surrounded by Enemies. Imagine that on November 22nd, they shot at Jack Kennedy and missed. Okay, on November 23rd, he and his brother Bobby are going to wake up in Washington, D.C., and they're going to wonder – you know, the life is not going to ping back to normal. These two guys are going to look around the landscape, the political landscape, and say, somebody just tried to assassinate him in broad daylight, in public, in front of a national television audience. And they're not going to take kindly to that. And they're going to have a lot of resources, and they're going to fight back. And that's what the book is about.
When you look at that picture... and you're right in that we all have a mental image of Kennedy, one that's an emotional one as well as one that is a visual, because the dude was cool. He was way cool. And I look at this picture, and you know what? That's a guy that had it all. At that moment in time, when that picture was taken and leading right up until when he was shot in Dallas, that he was in control of the known universe at that moment. And you're right. He was a man's man and a woman's man, too, as well.
Yeah. And I look into these pictures that you put up, and they're just kind of a montage of insanity, I guess. But the one picture that's not up there is the book cover of Surrounded by Enemies, where it has a different image of John Kennedy. And, you know, I think the interesting thing is John Kennedy was many things to many people. And what the premise of Surrounded by Enemies that I think is makes it unique is that here is a guy who would have Well, let me put it this way. In our timeline, in our time frame, and what really happened, there was a steady drip, drip, drip of scandal that kind of has undermined his character over the last 50 years. But what if that drip, drip, drip didn't drip out over 50 years but came out over 18 months? What would that have done? And so what I think would have happened if he'd survived Dallas is the investigations into the shooting and who might want to kill the president would have peeled back the onion sufficiently that a lot of these things that were suppressed in our time frame would have come out during a different time frame.
And we're so comforted with hindsight. You know, hindsight is a bitch. I mean, that's exactly what we have with us and looking back. But do you just find that the tragedy that has followed that family since that assassination just to be just out of control? I mean, just not fair.
Well, you know, life isn't fair. And if the Kennedys wanted safety and security, they probably wouldn't have become public figures. I mean, there's a risk, particularly maybe not so much when John was running and then assassinated, but his brother certainly knew of the risk. You know, it is a tragic family. People have written about the Kennedy curse. But what I actually found most compelling, because when I put Surrounded by Enemies out last year, there's a whole avalanche, a tsunami, if you will, of Kennedy books coming out for the 50th anniversary.
That's right.
So I had to really try to look at what he did in a different way. And the thing is, the Kennedy curse and the tragedy that you're talking about really is amplified and begins, even though there are other events prior, but it really begins and takes force when he dies in Dallas, Texas.
Right.
So my feeling was, if he didn't die in Dallas, Texas, there wouldn't be that protective aura of tragedy, around him. That's what kept his image. That's what created the Camelot fantasy, if you will, because he died. You know, you're not going to take a swipe at a dead man. But if he didn't die, then a lot of the things people have said about John Kennedy, even historians, that he was always living one headline away from disaster during his presidency, what with the women and the lies about his medical condition,
right,
and many of the things that were going on in terms of the intelligence agencies and assassinations of other leaders, for example. And these kind of things could have come out, and the Kennedy that would have been exposed under those circumstances would not have been a martyr. He would have been just a political figure as he was. And remember, Kennedy barely got elected in 60. There were just as many people who didn't want him to be president as the ones who did. So I think the fallacy of the people who have done these what ifs about John Kennedy over the years is they've always focused on, well, gosh, what would he have done about Vietnam? And, would the world have been so much a better place? The thing is, that's only if they hadn't shot at him in Dallas. Right. If they'd shot at him in Dallas, he and his brother would have been pissed off, right, and would have wanted to take some accounting of what had happened. And that's what I found as a dramatist to be a far better story.
Well, I don't want to keep people from buying the book, but I need to ask some questions.
Sure. Because I hope they buy it anyway.
Well, but okay. So take it as far as you want. Did Oswald act alone?
Well, okay. I can answer that easily as Bryce answering a question about what I feel, and then I can also answer it, from the book's point of view. From my own personal opinion, I think in the same way that I'm willing to say there's a lot of misrepresentations in the UFO field, but I still believe Roswell is a true event, or forget Roswell. There's a lot of misrepresentations in the UFO field, but I still feel there's an underlying reality to it.
Right.
I feel the same way about Oswald. While there's a lot of confusion in it, for me, the reading that I've done over the last 30 years leads me to a relatively high degree of satisfaction that he didn't act alone, that there was a conspiracy. Now, whether Oswald was part of that conspiracy and manipulated in it is something people can argue about and will probably argue about for hundreds of years from now. In the book, I've done two things in the book that I think are intriguing. The first is that John Kennedy obviously survives, but the second is that so does Oswald. And I don't want to tell you too much more because I want you to read the book.
Okay.
I think it's an interesting tale, but these are pretty interesting flips of history that could easily have happened. And you know, I feel like there's the answer to your question about whether Oswald acted alone or not certainly would have been addressed in a trial.
Which never happened.
No, but it does in my book.
It does. Okay. Well, then that's an then I'm going to take poetic license here. Then I'm going to talk to you as Bryce Zabel, the man, as opposed to Bryce Zabel, the author. Okay.
All right.
Now, the thing with Oswald, well, and also last year when all of the documentaries started to come out, and it was on so many different channels, and I had forgotten what I was like. What is with this tsunami of Kennedy stuff this year? I'd forgotten it was his 50th. You know.
Yeah, that's why. I mean, you won't get it every year. You just got it this year.
Yeah, and so it was all coming, and I just started watching all of it. Now there were a couple of different takes, and I want your take on this because I know that you've either seen the documentaries or heard. About the Secret Service agent in the car behind him is the guy that actually shot him.
Oh, that one I didn't buy.
Yeah.
I saw it. I didn't buy it.
Now, the research was compelling.
I did the same thing you did. I set my DVR and I recorded something like 20 some hours of JFK programming. I'd already finished my book by that point, so it didn't really inform the book. That came from reading things.
Right.
But I think some of them were just reaching for certain conclusions. And that one in particular, I've seen enough and read enough evidence that causes me to say that was misinformed. But that's just my opinion. I could be wrong.
Now, who do you think, I'm just talking to you, Bryce Zabel, the guy that's done the research, not the author. Who do you think that Oswald was involved with?
Well, I think that there's some, you know, he might have honestly just been drinking a Coke on the second floor, for all I know. I think it's hard. There's a lot of conflicting testimony and evidence. It's just as confusing as the UFO field, for sure. So the short answer is we'll never know. But what I think is that there were forces in play in 1963 that we can't dispute. And that those forces that were actually intermingling with each other at that time included the CIA and the anti-Castro Cubans and the mob. All right, they were all interacting because there were plots to kill Castro.
And you can't leave the Soviet Union out of the mix as well.
Well, I can't leave them out, although I tend to right now. I don't. They were not interacting in that triad of interest: CIA, anti-Castro Cubans, and mob. Those three were acting together for a period of time during Kennedy's administration. And the one thing I would ask everybody to consider as a fact is that on November 22nd, 1963, all three of them hated Jack Kennedy with a passion.
Right, okay? Right.
The mob definitely hated him because they felt betrayed. And frankly, Kennedy was sleeping with one of the women who was Giancana's girlfriend. So the mob hated him. They always had hated him since the election. The CIA hated him because Kennedy was so upset about the Bay of Pigs that he threatened to destroy the CIA and shatter it and send it to the winds. So obviously they hated him. And the anti-Castro Cubans felt betrayed by Kennedy. They hated him. I'm just saying, when you get a group of people who are talking about committing an assassination of one leader, Castro, and they all hate Kennedy, it's not a great leap of faith that that group was manipulated in various ways, official or unofficial, to end Kennedy.
There's one thing. Have you ever shot a rifle? A BB gun? It doesn't even matter. Have you ever shot anything like that?
Yes, I have, yeah.
We all have, okay? And it is not easy. It looks good in the movies. It looks fun. It looks easy. Oh, yeah. All right. But the one fact that and I'm not some investigator. I don't have, you know, some kind of sniper medal on, you know, I haven't been to boot camp, nothing like that. But, you know, I've goofed around with guns as a kid. And to get those shots off like that, like he supposedly did, for anybody that wants to say that it was a lone gunman, they're out of their mind. It's impossible.
Yeah, I don't buy it.
You know, I have tried to shoot at a target that is, you know, 10 yards in front of me and missed it. You know what I mean?
Well, you know what the thing is, though, what I find to be really odd is the pushback from the media that wants to kind of, you know, slap their hands together and go, okay, folks, nothing to see here. Oswald acted alone. You know, we've had our little dalliance with conspiracy, but now it's all, you know, now we can, it's all taken care of. I mean, and look, you know, that's really awful book by Bugliosi, Reclaiming History,
right,
that ended up getting optioned by Tom Hanks and made into Parkland, which was, you know, to me, a very dishonest film. You know, what's with this pushback that we have to say Oswald acted alone? If there's one thing I'm relatively sure of, he didn't act alone. I can't tell you specifically who did pull the trigger, and maybe Oswald was one of them. He might have, you know, it's quite possible, but it sure doesn't look like he acted alone. And when I see all this, you know, when I see the NBC, you know, the NBC show that tries to go out of its way to say Oswald acted alone, I go, what's going on here?
Right.
It's really topsy-turvy to me. I don't buy it.
Right. And I'm not a smart guy, but to be able to reload, cock that gun and fire it again and again and again and get those shots and hit the target, a moving target at that, is crazy. It didn't happen that way. And you can't convince me. You know, and I just don't understand why they want to, like you said, the pushback, why they want to keep pushing this issue when it's just obvious. There's just no way. I don't care who.
You have to ask yourself, when people do things, what are their motivations? Okay, the only motivation for doing that with the Kennedy assassination at this point, I guess, is that it's a destabilizing thing to think about your institutions conspiring to kill the president. But my God, 50 years ago, you know, let's let it go. And the same, you know, that I guess there'd be more reason to continue to cover up UFO reality, because, you know, that once you let that cat out of the bag, life doesn't go on as normal.
Right.
Okay. If Obama went on TV tomorrow and said, ladies and gentlemen, you know, I've just seen some declassified documents, and it looks to me like President Kennedy was killed in a conspiracy, and our own CIA may have had something to do with it. I'm deeply sorry, and I offer the nation's apologies to the Kennedy family. Life would pretty much go on.
Exactly. I mean,
nothing would change. However, if Obama went on TV and said, I've seen classified documents that show that not only was Roswell real, but we don't have a clue what these things flying around are, and we're very worried about it, well, then life would change.
There's an issue, right.
There's a difference in these two issues that has to be taken into account.
Is there anybody, and this is, you're right, is there anybody even alive that was in Dallas? It was 50 years ago. You know, who's going to be harmed now? You know, there's not any, I doubt there's anybody left in Russia or Cuba, well, aside from Castro.
But it's the damnedest thing, though, because think about it. You're absolutely right. Nobody really is going to be harmed by fessing up on that, and yet there is this really powerful undercurrent from the 50th anniversary that somehow it was simpler than you thought. It wasn't a conspiracy. It was just Oswald. And, you know, I just, you know, I'll give you an example. You know, my book is a what-if book about Kennedy. There's another what-if that came out this year from Jeff Greenfield, who's a political commentator. And I've always enjoyed his work. And so I corresponded with him as sort of friendly, you know, author to author. And, you know, he went out of his way to say, I will. He wrote his book from the point of view that there was no conspiracy, and that people that talk about conspiracies make him angry.
Okay.
And I was kind of stunned. I mean, I thought we were just kind of having a collegial back and forth, and he was like, it just really, So his book, for example, is Kennedy gets shot at, but guess what? Everything pretty much just goes back to normal, and Kennedy goes on about his life, and the nation goes on about its life. I just respectfully disagree. I don't think that that would have happened, and I also think that, anybody with half a brain after a mass shooting in Dallas would have still said, who was behind this? From his point of view, it didn't even matter.
Think about what you just said. It happened that way to Reagan.
Yeah.
Huh.
Well, yeah, but
went right back to normal. In fact, he walked out of, it was like it didn't. He wanted to act like it didn't even happen. That's an interesting take.
Huh. Well, here's the thing, though. I from that point of view, then that would support Greenfield's
position. Right. I never thought of it that way.
But I don't think that because Reagan didn't have a record. He was shot 2 months into his term. So there wasn't anything to uncover about the Reagan administration. And, there wasn't a real deep interest to say there had to be more to it than this crazy John Hinckley guy, even though there might have been. I mean, I don't want to get into the Reagan.
But
what I would say about the Kennedy one is at that point, you're dealing with 3.5 years in office and a lot of stuff that had gone on, from Bay of Pigs to Cuban Missile Crisis to the civil rights to the CIA to the
mafia.
Lot of stuff going on. And when you have a calculated hit, in what looks like a triangulated zone, I think that's a slightly different thing than a guy with a handgun on a street that catches the president with, like they did with Reagan. So I do think there would have been more investigations. Also because, there's a lot more to investigate. My God.
Could you make a movie out of this book? I mean, would the public accept something like that?
I hope. I mean, I didn't write it to be necessarily the underlying rights for a movie, but it would be an excellent movie. It might become, the pilot of a television series on other what ifs, maybe. But why I wrote it, though, is I just realized that I've had this idea for like 10 years, and I realized if I didn't write it for the 50th anniversary, it would never get written. And the other reason I wrote it is that my mentor was a fellow who he died last year, but he was he partied with Kennedy. He literally had been at Peter Lawford's house when JFK and Marilyn were cavorting and going in the back pool house. He told me stories. That's all I want to say. He told me stories. And when I first told him about the book that I wanted to write, he said, why do you have to do that? Don't write that. JFK was a great guy. I really enjoyed hanging around with him. Okay. And he did. He was a great party guy. So I waited till my friend had passed on out of respect for him. And then when he was gone, I said, well, the 50th anniversary is coming up. My friend's dead. I'm going to do it now. So that's why I did it last year.
Do they, in the book, I mean, do you, again, I want people to buy the book. I haven't read it yet, and I know that I will. But, I mean, do they just like wreak havoc? Are those two brothers just like really angry?
Well, here's how I try to tell the story of the book. It's written as if it is a 50th anniversary look back at the near miss in Dallas and the impact that had on the Kennedy administration and the years to come. So it's like imagine Time magazine from an alternative universe writing about Kennedy living.
Bizarre world.
That's the way it's told. So when we started this conversation, these hours ago, talking about the journalism in my background, I wrote it as from a journalistic point of view. So it doesn't read like a classic novel. People who read it say it reads like an honest to God history book, and it makes them start to question, wait a minute, did that really happen? Wait, he didn't really do that, did he? So that's what I've tried to do. Tried to sell it to the viewer or to the audience reader as journalism from an alternative world.
Now, there is a link directly to the book. The link goes to Cyberblaze, which is actually a pretty cool little site that you put together. It's called Cyberblaze. You just click on Bryce's name right there, either on the guest page or on the homepage, and it'll take you to the cover of the book that you've been talking about, but also a quick background on the book.
And the thing is, the simplest thing is just go to surroundedbyenemies.com and you can go straight to where the book is. I'm not actually, you know, listen, I love that people read the book. I love to talk about it. I feel like in this tsunami of Kennedy books, there was a monochromatic kind of feeling to it of, you know, just the homage. And I feel like it is, while there were some very unique ones, most of them weren't. I feel like this is one of them. This is at least one that will make you think differently about the JFK years.
So what else are you going to do this year? Obviously, you're at the Berlin Film Festival. And, you know what? We haven't even talked about the film festival. And we're nearly out of time. We're at the end of the show. Believe it or not, I can't even believe we blazed through this much time and left so much untalked about. But what untalked about, is that a right word, Mr. Journalist guy? Is that even
I
a word?
I probably my professor would fail you for that.
Not talked about. What is the purpose of the film festival and why are you there?
I'm working on my German. Two things go on simultaneously. The Berlin Film Festival is an international festival of great merit, and a lot of people come here, and it's a big deal to Hollywood and so forth. But at the same time, they have what's also called the European Film Market, which is sort of like the AFM that we have, the American Film Market, where, you know, it's a giant bazaar of buying and selling and marketing people coming together over films that either are not yet made or are going to be made or have been made but haven't found distribution. So, there, you know, it's like going to a giant convention and walking around the booths, you know. It could be a dental convention, except what they're selling isn't dental stuff. They're selling movies.
I get it.
And so it's kind of a fascinating way to see things. And why I'm here is simply that the model for my career so far has been you get an idea, you go pitch it to a network or a studio, they like it, they pay you to write it. If you're lucky, they make it. But I believe that the world has changed so dramatically, the technology, but also just the way movies are made, that you have to be more of an entrepreneur. And so while I am a writer, producer, I feel like you can't just think about writing or making the movies. You have to think about selling and marketing and bringing the movie to life. I mean, a producer has to be able to make a movie come to life. And so two of the projects that I'm most interested in right now here at the festival are Majic Men, which we've talked about. Mm-hmm. But the other one is something that is really near and dear to my heart, and it has nothing to do with fantasy. It's called The Last Battle. It's a book that came out last year and made it on the New York Times bestseller list. It's literally the story of the last battle of World War II in Europe after Hitler's death on April 30th, but before the Nazis, the Germans surrendered on May 8th. It was a very dangerous place. And true story, absolute true story, a band of Americans are sent into the Austrian Alps to a castle where all the French premiers and presidents and generals have been kept during the war to rescue them. And the Americans rescue these French prisoners. What they don't know is that 200 angry, liquored-up, pissed-off Waffen-SS troops have surrounded the castle with orders from Himmler to kill everybody inside so that they don't testify at war crimes trials. And so the Americans have to turn to the Germans who just surrendered to them and say, if we give you your guns back, who are you going to shoot, us or them? The Germans and the Americans fight together for the only time in World War II. And this is the only book that's ever been written about the story. And I own the rights to it, and I'm trying to set it up as a movie. That's a great story. I mean, it's just a great story.
Well, you know, and I almost want to say, you know, you couldn't have made that story up. You know, you take a Hollywood scriptwriter, you couldn't have written that. But that's,
if I had made it up, people would say, no, that's too crazy. We can't do that.
So, again, and they did fight the battle, and did they free? I mean, the book's out, so you can tell me the ending. What actually happened? So
what happened is it became the Alamo in the Alps. The Waffen SS that surrounded the castle outnumbered the people who were defending the castle 200-1. I mean, excuse me, 10-1. There were 200 versus 20, so it was 10-1. So it was the Alamo. Only the difference is in the Alamo everybody died, and here actually the Americans, the Germans, and the French managed to hold on long enough that they could be rescued. And as the rescue troops are arriving, these Americans and Germans and French were running out of all ammo and were preparing to go to the castle keep and fight hand-to-hand combat.
That's incredible.
And then they got saved, and the Germans, the Waffen SS, disappeared into the forest and were later, you know, rounded up and carted off. But
well, I can help you out here. You know, you don't have to worry about a thing. That film's going to get made. So
great. I mean, it's so great, and I'm thrilled to be. It was written by Stephen Harding, a military historian, and I've been working with Stephen on it. He told me about the story almost 10 years ago, and I encouraged him to continue to work on it. I started developing it as a movie, and I literally had written a script for the movie a couple of years ago. I was going to take that out and try to sell it, and Stephen said, you know what, that's gotten me inspired. I'm going to do the book. So I waited for the book to come out, and now we're going to set the book up, and then you know, I'll do the next draft.
So in at the film festival, and I'm assuming this goes on at Cannes and other film festivals too as well, probably Sundance, but you know, you have you guys, your side, the writers, and you know, they go there with the screenplay, but on the other side there's everybody that's showing up looking for you.
Well, yeah, I I'm not exactly playing by the standard set of rules for even the European film market. I mean, most people are here because they've produced a film, but they don't have distribution or marketing. Mm-hmm. So that's what probably most of the conversations are about. But let's face it, in today's world, you can't produce or market something unless you have a good idea, and it all starts with a story.
Right.
And so particularly a story that has underlying rights to it like this, I'm looking to find about the only thing I want to borrow from the Bush years is this phrase. I'm looking for a coalition of the willing to make this movie. And, you know, this seems like a very strong place to start. And the main thing I'm here for with The Last Battle is if there was ever a movie that needs to be a co-production, that needs to involve German filmmakers and production in a co-production with Americans, it would be The Last Battle.
Right. Yeah. And you're in Berlin. Yeah. It should be a no-brainer. Yeah. Well, yeah. Listen, I've got to finish the show, so I'm going to go ahead and go. But when you're going to be back in the next couple of days, right?
I'm here for a. You know, I don't even know. I'm still jet lagged, but yeah, I'm here for. I think till next week. Having a good time, and I enjoyed opening up the bottom floor of the Berlin Grand Westin here with you, and it was great.
You can blame it all on the American.
I want to thank all your listeners too, and I didn't mean to go off on the guy that didn't sign his name. I think it's fine, but you know, it's just that, you know, I'm a journalist at heart. I like people to be on the record.
Well, in an alternative universe. He didn't sign his name. So there you
go. Listen, so I'll close by just saying surroundedbyenemies.com. Check that out. And I love any of your thoughts. It's been doing very well on Amazon. It's got 57 reviews now, and it's got a 4.6 out of 5, so I'm thrilled.
Well, the links are up. The links are all there. And by the end of the evening tonight, we'll have a bunch of other stuff up there for you. But
thank you all. It was great, man. I really, you got a great show, and it was a fun interview to do.
And again, we'll get you back on here in a couple of months. We'll come back and you'll have some good news for us.
All right. Thanks so much.
All the best, Bryce. Have a safe trip back, and I'll talk to you when you get back to town. JimmyChurchRadio.com. This is Fade to Black. I am your host, Jimmy Church. We might have some time for a quick phone call or two. 323-825-5045. I've got a bunch of other stuff I got to get to in this last few minutes of the show. Thank you, Bryce. Live from Berlin. I'll tell you what. Kennedy was a man's man. Bryce is a man's man. I am your host, Jimmy Church. Fade to Black, Dark Matter Radio Network. Stay with us. Be back right after this.
This is William from La Crescenta, and I listen to JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Jimmy Church.
Church. My name is Alan, and I listen to JimmyChurchRadio.com.
He's always giving it to you straight.
JimmyChurchRadio.com.
On the Dark Matter Radio Network.
Hi, this is Rob Reiner from Anvil, and you're listening to JimmyChurchRadio.com.
What's up? I'm Chris.
What up? This is Kyle Massey, and you're listening to Jimmy Church Radio, the revolution.
Oh, yeah. Fade to Black. Dark Matter Radio Network. Shoot me some email, Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. Follow us on Twitter at JChurchRadio. Bryce Zabel. I can't say enough. And when you get a chance to talk to somebody like Bryce and the conversation is going like that, it just is going to keep going. That's just it. I can't stop, and I hope everybody out there was enjoying themselves as much as I was. And again, I hope you're a little jealous that I can just sit here and have that conversation. But the point of it all is that you can sit there and listen. And I hope that you enjoyed it as much as I did. Bryce Zabel, extraordinary. Now, he did, during the show, sent me the link to, and we're going to put it up right now on the website, for the YouTube video of Art Bell on Dark Skies, where Art Bell plays William Paley of Majestic 12. And I remember that, and Bryce and I were talking about it before the show, and I was like, oh, man, we've got to get that up there. So the link to the Dark Skies video with Art Bell playing William Paley, we'll have that link up there. If it's not up there already, it will be by the end of the show. Okay? All right. Now, the contest that we are having, remember, this is the deal, and we've got a bunch of responses tonight. I haven't gone and checked. Okay? The contest is very simple. We have a bunch of Easter eggs all over JimmyChurchRadio.com. They're everywhere. And each Easter egg has got a little thing. I'm not going to tell you what it is. It's got a little thing tied to it. How many Easter eggs are there, and what is tied to that Easter egg? It's a contest. Figure it out. JimmyChurchRadio.com. Easter eggs. It's cool, and it's fun. And after we get this contest done, and it'll be finished here in 10 minutes, there's going to be a third winner. Get in on it, because we're going to replace those Easter eggs and probably start it all over again. Okay, now it's really cool. Now I'm giving away, we've already given away two DVDs of UFO stuff. I don't want to say what it is because it's really cool. When you get it in the mail, you're going to be like, man, love Fade to Black. This is really cool. There's a reason for it. Okay, now, please, everybody get on it. Okay, now, next is the hoax stuff. Now, again, I got a bunch of email tonight, and I got it all week long on what is a hoax and what isn't. And for me, it's not about the person. It's about the story. And I got a bunch of email this week. I don't want to name names because it just wouldn't be right because it's not what I believe in, which is, could a person be a hoax? No, it's a story. And there are so many names out there that offend so many people. And I'm watching these emails come in and these comments, and I get what you're trying to say. But no, a person can't be a hoax. A story is a hoax. And next Thursday, I am going to have on George Hansen. And he's an author, ufologist, paranormal, ghost hunter, magician. Okay? He's a magician. But what he does is he investigates hoaxes. That's one of his things. He's got some books out. So he's going to come in next week, and we're going to talk about a couple of very specific cases. And these cases that we're going to talk about are ongoing to this day. And I don't mean to offend anybody out there, but it's just one of these situations where I am going to present one side, he's going to present the other side, and we're going to let you make up your own minds. And the thing is, and Bryce and I were talking about this today, and I think I even talked about it last night and the night before, and that is this. When somebody has a story, or a group of people have a story, or one person has a story, and they tell the story, they allow themselves to spin it out of control, out of necessity for attention on themselves. Maybe it's money. Maybe it's anger. I don't know, but they allow what could be and what should be a nice, solid, legitimate situation, and they allow themselves to get out of control. And they let the story get more fantastical. And they don't have to do that. And then it turns into a hoax, where now the attention is back on to a group of people or a single person, where the fantastical parts are getting picked apart. And if that part of the story is untrue, then is it all untrue? And that is that's what we're going to talk about next Thursday with these two cases that I'm going to put on the table for everybody. And again, I'm not making a personal attack on anybody. I'm just showing you where you have a certain situation where the truth is there. It's okay. Everything is fine. And then these people allow themselves to get sucked in, like Bryce was saying, down that rabbit hole, and they allow the story to just get out of control. And that's going to be next Thursday. And I think hoaxes in our industry, the fact that we have allowed this stuff to get into our industry and allow to damage and pollute a subject that not only it's not just UFOs, but it's paranormal, and it's abductions and lost civilizations and anything else that isn't necessarily factually based. It allows everything to just spin completely out of control, where they look back at everybody talking and just saying, look, if one thing is untrue, it's just like being in court. If one thing isn't true, then it's all untrue. And we just don't need that. And I will point the finger if I need to point the finger. And that's what next Thursday is going to be all about. I'm going to take a quick break. We'll be right back to close out the show. This is Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. This is the Dark Matter Radio Network. Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. All comments after the show tonight, as always, I'll be over on the social forums at JimmyChurchRadio.com. Causing trouble. That's what I do. All right? I'll be back right after this. Stay with us.
Despite popular opinion, reading a book will not make you smarter.
But listening to Jimmy Church will, on the Dark Matter Radio Network.
He's always giving it to you straight.
JimmyChurchRadio.com.
On the Dark Matter Radio Network.
This is KJCR at JimmyChurchRadio.com.
On the Dark Matter Radio Network.
All right, everybody, welcome back. KJCR, JimmyChurchRadio.com. Fade to black. Shoot me an email to Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com, and that email better be about the contest, the Easter egg contest. You're running out of time, everybody. I'm serious. The Easter egg contest. How many Easter eggs are there? What's tied to that Easter egg? And I'm giving away a really cool UFO DVD. We've already given away two. We've got one left. We've got a bunch of email going for it, and this is it. Friday was the deadline. Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. Shoot me that email. Follow us on Twitter at JChurchRadio. And forget the YouTube, but go over to YouTube and subscribe. I think it's KJCR Fade to Black is the YouTube channel, and we do post all of the shows. All of this week's shows will be up. And for your listening pleasure tomorrow, and we do the same thing every single week. All right. Now, I wanted to talk about real quick. I had done a little editorial last week about Mars, the explorers, and what's going on over there. And the fact that we don't get any information out of Mars. But now, this week, there's been a lawsuit about that very same subject matter. Go to artbell.com and look at the article and what is going on right now with the lawsuit that is presented in court right now. And it's exactly about what I was talking about last week. Coincidence? I don't know. It just feels a little funny to me. I forget who said, who was it? Was it Mr. Snorri that said that there are no coincidences, right? Okay, everybody knows what I'm talking about. But a coincidence? I just don't think so. Now, I'm not talking about me last week and what I spoke about, and that's part of, no, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying last week that rock happened, we've had all of these issues going down of lack of information coming off of Mars. I just happened to notice what was going on, but then this lawsuit happens this week, and there you go. So go and check that out. The entire story is right there at artbell.com. I've been more than a little upset about it, and I spent a lot of time last week talking about it, and I'm emotional about it, and I want something. And now this week, The rock happens, and now this lawsuit, and I'm just saying. All right, my producer's in my ear that we are out of time. So listen, everybody, have a great weekend. Let me get the music cued, and then I'm getting ready to get out of here. But I will say this. I want some information over the weekend on hoaxes. Who you think is the perpetrator of a hoax. Okay? We'll do the show next Thursday. I've already got a couple of things lined up. So I want that info over the weekend. I've got about 10 ideas from everybody this week. I can't do them all, but I just want the best. Okay, so let's do that. Also, you know what? There was something else that I needed information from everybody on, but it's just not going to matter because we are just about out of time. This is Fade to Black. I am your host, Jimmy Church. There was one other thing, and I just can't remember. So you know what? Coming up next is After Dark with Brian Alvarez. One of the best shows on Dark Matter. Go check that out. Fade to Black is produced by Rita Kamurian, executive producer. Special thanks, as always, to the master himself, Keith Rowland. The show is produced by Hilton J. Palm. The announcers are Steve Harder and Mark D. Kovar. The D is there to separate him from all those other Mark Kovars out there around the world. The music you are listening to right now is Doug Aldrich, White Snake. Fade to Black is produced by KJCR on the Dark Matter Radio Network. I am your host, Jimmy Church. Have a great weekend, everybody. See you next week.